Following lecture is going to be a quick crash course on chemical bonding, and we would be targeting the A-level syllabus for Cambridge CAIE. So we'll start off with the first type of bonding, which is called sigma covalent bonds, and it's also referred to by its Greek symbol, which is sigma over here. So this letter, this Greek letter over here, would represent sigma from now on. And I'm going to explain sigma covalent bonds by this example over here, where two hydrogens, one hydrogen atom is bonding with another hydrogen atom to form an H2 molecule. And let's see how sigma bonds are formed between these molecules, these two H atoms. So remember your O-levels, that hydrogen had one proton, that's one proton over here, and it had one electron in its only single shell. So there was only one electron roaming around. The other hydrogen also has one proton and one electron. What would happen is this hydrogen needs one electron in its outer shell. It tries to gain an electron from the other hydrogen atom. The other hydrogen atom would do the same. This hydrogen atom over here would try to gain an electron from the other hydrogen atom. So it's going to try and pull its electron. And what would eventually happen is that the electron of this hydrogen and both electrons, they would end up getting shared, because both atoms were pulling the electrons of each other, and the electrons would get stuck somewhere in the middle. And this was the covalent bond that was formed. If you remember chemical bonding from your O levels, this was the dot and cross diagram when two hydrogen atoms bonded with each other. They were both pulling each other's electrons. The electrons, both electrons, they got stuck somewhere in the middle. So you've studied that hydrogen atom, one electron. You've studied about orbitals. And you know that hydrogen has an electronic configuration of 1s1, which basically means there's one electron in an s orbital, which is spherical. So this is what it's going to look like, a proton and one electron in a spherical region around this proton. So that electron would be roaming around somewhere in this spherical area around the nucleus. It would be attracted to the nucleus. And then there's going to be another hydrogen atom, which is going to look exactly the same. So this other hydrogen atom, again, one proton and one electron in a spherical area around this nucleus, somewhere in this area, whizzing around. So that one electron is in this area, and the same thing would pretty much happen. The electrons are going to this orbital over here needs one electron. Remember, 1s can accommodate a maximum of two electrons, so it needs one electron. So this hydrogen, if it sees the other hydrogen atom's electron, it's going to try and attract that electron, and the other hydrogen atom would do exactly the same. It needs one electron in its s orbital. So if it sees the other atom's electron, it's going to try and pull that electron towards it. So they're both trying to pull the electrons towards each other. And what's going to eventually happen is that the two electrons would get stuck somewhere in the middle. These two electrons, let's write them down. Those two electrons are being pulled by both nuclei. Both nuclei are trying to gain those electrons. So those electrons, because the force of attraction is going to be equal, so the two electrons are going to get stuck somewhere in the middle. They wouldn't be able to go towards this hydrogen nucleus, or they would not be able to go towards the other hydrogen atom's nucleus. So those electrons would be stuck somewhere in this middle region connecting the two nuclei. Somewhere in this middle area, the electron density is going to be very, very high. So they're now going to form a bonding orbital. Remember what an orbital was? Orbital was the place where there was a very high probability to find those electrons. Now, this electron was first, previously, when it was an isolated atom, was found in a spherical area around the nucleus somewhere over here. This electron was also found somewhere in the spherical area. But once the two hydrogen atoms are bonding to each other, the electrons are stuck somewhere in the middle. So the electrons are now found somewhere in this area. So I would need to draw a new bonding orbital. And a new bonding orbital would look something like this. This would be the high probability area of finding the electron. This is the place where the electrons are most likely to be found. So this would be your bonding orbital. And this is known as the sigma bond. So why is there a force of attraction? Why is there a bond forming? The shared electrons are getting attracted to the two nuclei. So there's a force of attraction that is holding them all together. Electrons in the middle, nucleus over here, and a nucleus over here. So there's attraction, there's mutual attraction, nucleus attracting the shared electrons attracting the other nucleus. So they're all held tightly together. So there's a bond forming now. And this orbital over here would be known as the bonding orbital. This would be known as the sigma bond. This is the place where there's a very high probability of finding the electrons now. So let's draw this neatly now. Here is a neater version of an SNS overlap that we described over here. So this is where you're going to have a high probability area of finding the electron. And this picture over here represents the summary of what was happening. You had two hydrogen atoms. You had electrons in a spherical region around the nucleus. This is the center part of the nucleus. And similarly, this is another hydrogen atom with its electrons around the nucleus. And they would start attracting each other's electrons. They would try to gain electrons and the electrons would eventually get together in the middle. They would not be able to, none of the hydrogen atoms would be able to attract the electrons. So the electron density would be maximum somewhere in the middle. Both the atoms would be attracting each of the electrons. So the new bonding orbital is going to have this shape over here. So this is what an S and S overlap would look like. Now let's quickly talk about another type of sigma bond, which is between an S orbital and a P orbital. So it's called an S and P overlap. The example that I've chosen to represent this is an HF molecule. If you look at a hydrogen atom and its electronic configuration, it has a 1s1 orbital, that's it. So it needs an electron in this 1s orbital. If you look at the fluorine atom, it has 9 electrons, so the electronic configuration is going to be 1s2, 2s2, 2px2, 2py2 and 2pz1. So this orbital over here needs an electron, it needs one electron, and fluorine's all orbitals are full, except for the last one, 2pz. So this orbital over here needs one electron. So it's going to be, fluorine would try to gain an electron in the 2pz orbital. It's going to try and pull an electron from hydrogen into its 2pz orbital. It's going to try and gain an electron. And hydrogen would do exactly the same. Hydrogen needs one electron in its orbital, so it's going to try and pull fluorine's electron into its, and it's going to try and fill its electron. I've drawn the orbitals of fluorine and hydrogen that are going to bond with each other. I've ignored all these orbitals over here because they're completely full. They can't be involved in bonding because they don't need any electrons. So I've only drawn the pz orbital, a p orbital of fluorine, and I've only drawn the s orbital. So what's going to happen is hydrogen needs one electron, so hydrogen is going to try and pull fluorine's electron. This electron, there was one electron in PZ, so there was one electron roaming around in this area. So hydrogen is going to try and pull that electron towards it. It's going to try and fill its orbital. The same would happen with hydrogen's own electron because hydrogen had one electron in the 1s orbital. So fluorine would try to fill its electron, its orbital. It's going to try and pull that electron into its orbital. So both atoms would try to tug on each other's electrons. Eventually, the electrons would get stuck somewhere in the middle. Electron density would be maximum in the region in the center over here because electrons would not be able to go to either fluorine or to hydrogen. Electrons would get stuck somewhere in the middle. Summarize this. This is what the bonding orbital would look like. The electron density would be maximum somewhere in the middle over here between the two nuclei. Both nucleus trying to pull the electrons. The electron would not really go on the other side or towards the other side. So the bonding orbital would look something like this, where the maximum electron density, the region of maximum electron probability, is going to lie between the two nuclei. This is where you're more likely to find those two electrons. So somewhere here between the two nuclei, that's where the electrons would be. So the lobe on the right for fluorine, this atom over here was fluorine. And this nuclei over here belonged to hydrogen. So the lobe over here on this side would be lesser because the electron is going to get pulled by the hydrogen on the other side. And similarly, the hydrogen's lobe would be attracted to fluorine. So hydrogen's electron density would move or shift towards fluorine. And there's going to be a head-to-head overlap between a p orbital and an s orbital. We'll discuss the third type of sigma bond, which is a p and p overlap. It's basically an overlap between a p orbital and another p orbital from another atom. So the example that I'm going to do to show you a p and p overlap is going to be a fluorine molecule. We're going to have one fluorine bonded to another fluorine. Now, we've previously just discussed what fluorine's electronic configuration is. 9 electrons, so it's 1s2, 2s2, 2px2, 2py2. So all the orbitals are full except for this last one. This orbital is not full, it needs an electron. And the other fluorine is also going to have exactly the same electronic configuration. It needs an electron in the 2pz. So what's going to happen is that this fluorine is going to try and fill its empty orbital, 2pz. It needs one electron. The other fluorine is also going to try and fill its empty orbital. It's also a 2pz. It's also a p orbital and it needs one electron in that orbital as well. I've drawn my two fluorines. I've not drawn any of the other orbitals because they're completely full, so they're not involved in bonding. So I'm only going to be interested in this 2pz orbital, this p orbital having one electron, this p orbital having one electron. So I've drawn I've drawn fluorine's orbital. This orbital over here has one electron. It needs an electron. The other fluorine also has a p orbital. It has one electron. So there's one electron roaming around in this specific area. This is the high probability area. We're going to try and where there's a very high probability of finding that electron. The other fluorine, exactly the same high probability area. It's a p orbital, so that's where the electron is more likely to be found. So this fluorine would try to grab the other fluorine atom's electron. It's going to try and pull that electron, and it's going to try and fill its empty p orbital. Whereas the other fluorine is also going to do exactly the same. It's going to try and pull the other fluorine atom's electron, and both atoms would start pulling each other's electrons, and they would try to gain or fill their orbitals. But what's going to happen is, since the electrons, and since both atoms are fluorine, they would have an equal force of attraction. So electrons would get stuck somewhere in the middle. This would be the high probability area of finding those two electrons. The electrons would not be able to go to either fluorine. This fluorine will not win this tug of war. The other fluorine will also not win the tug of war because they have equal attraction. So the electrons would be stuck somewhere in the middle. So this area in the middle would be the high probability area now. That's where your bonding orbital is going to be, because that's where you're going to find the two electrons. So the two electrons will not be, this area would be lesser in quantity because this would be a low probability area now, because the electron of this fluorine atom is being pulled by the other fluorine atom. So it's probably going to be lying somewhere in the middle. Same is the case. So this lobe over here is also going to shrink. The electron is not likely to go to the other side now because that electron is getting pulled by the other fluorine atom. So your bonding orbital is going to look something like this. Diagram over here represents the bonding orbital, the sigma bond that's going to be formed when a p orbital and another p orbital overlap end to end, forming a sigma bond. Electron density is maximum. In the middle now, the electrons, two electrons are stuck somewhere in the middle. They're being shared. And the probability of the electron going to the other lobes, that's going to be very low now. So they're going to be smaller in size. The middle part, that's going to be bigger in size because that's where the two electrons are more likely to be found. So this is what a sigma bond would look like if a p orbital overlaps with another p orbital. Quick summary of the three types of sigma bonds that you're going to study in A-levels. And the first one is an SNS orbital that we did. Both atoms would mutually attract each other's electrons, and the orbitals are going to merge, and it's going to form an oval-shaped region where the electron density would be lying between the two nuclei. Then we did an S and a P orbital overlap. Both atoms would try to pull each other's electrons, and if they try to pull each other's electrons, the electron density would be maximum somewhere in the middle between the two atoms, and one of the lobes, this P, would get attracted to the hydrogens and the electron density. This side of the lobe is going to be bigger in size now because that's the area where there's a higher probability of finding the electrons. And the last one that we did was a P and P orbital overlap. Both atoms try to mutually attract electrons, each other's electrons. So the lobe in the center is going to be bigger because that's where you're going to find those electrons now. So that's where the orbitals are going to merge. They're going to overlap. And that's the high probability area of finding the electron. So that's what a sigma bond would look like if it's a PNP overlap. Now, based on our very basic knowledge of sigma bonds, we're going to first try and do a few more examples of sigma bonds for slightly more complicated molecules. So for example, I'm going to pick a water molecule first. So a water molecule has two hydrogens bonded to an oxygen atom. This over here is an oxygen atom's electronic configuration, 1s2, 2s2, 2px2. It has 8 electrons, so 2py and 2pz are empty. Now, if you look at an oxygen atom, it has two orbitals that need an electron. So an electron needs to go, or it's going to try and fill an electron in the 2pz. It's also going to try and fill an electron in the 2py orbital as well. What I've done over here is that I've drawn the oxygen atom's two orbitals which need electrons. So I'm again going to just ignore the other orbitals because they're not going to be involved in bonding. They have complete electrons, so they don't need any electrons. So you have a 2py orbital and a 2pz orbital. So let's call this the y-axis. I'm calling this the y-axis. So let's put a p orbital on the y-axis, and the other one would be on the z-axis. So this one is over here on the z-axis. Let's call that 2pz. Both orbitals just have one electron, So there's one electron and one electron in both of the orbitals. So this electron means there's an electron somewhere in this high probability area over here in the P region. This electron in the 2pz means there's going to be a high probability area. This electron might be somewhere in this area. So this is the high probability area for that particular electron. So now in a water molecule, what happens is the oxygen atom is needing two electrons and it's bonded to two hydrogen atoms. Now, as you already know, hydrogen just has one electron, so that's 1s1. So it needs an electron in its s orbital. So it's going to try and pull oxygen's electron. Oxygen is going to try and pull hydrogen's electron. So this is what's going to happen. So this is my hydrogen. I've drawn the hydrogen. It needs one electron, so it sees oxygen's electron in one of its orbitals. It's going to try and pull that oxygen electron, and oxygen sees its electron. Oxygen is going to try and fill it. So they're going to mutually attract each other's electrons. And when they start attracting each other's electrons, the electron density in the middle over here between the two nuclei, there's a nuclei over here, and there's a nuclei over here for hydrogen. So the electron density would be maximum somewhere in this particular area over here. And as you can see from our basic knowledge, it's a p orbital overlapping with an s orbital. What would eventually happen is that the two orbitals are going to merge and there's going to be a bonding orbital. And pretty much the same thing would happen between this other p orbital and another hydrogen atom. So here's another hydrogen atom with its one electron. It sees oxygen's other orbital. It's going to try and attract that electron. Oxygen was going to try and pull its electrons. And eventually what would happen is that the two electrons would be stuck somewhere in the middle and the electron density would be maximum somewhere over here in the middle. And this is what's going to happen again. A P and an S orbital would overlap. So there's another sigma bond being formed over here. This was the first sigma bond that was formed between an oxygen orbital and a hydrogen atom. So oxygen over here is making two sigma bonds. One with this hydrogen, one with the other hydrogen, so because it had two orbitals. One orbital went and merged with one of the hydrogen atoms. The other orbital, which also needed an electron, started attracting electrons from another hydrogen atom. So two sigma bonds are going to be formed. And I'm going to draw a neater version of this, which is going to look something like this. So this is how the two sigma bonds are going to eventually look like. The P orbital over here, as you can see over here, went and got attracted to hydrogen atom over here. So it ended up merging over there. And the electron density was maximum between the two nuclei. The same happened with the other oxygen orbital. It went and merged with one of the hydrogen atoms over here. So that orbital, its electron density shifted towards hydrogen. So the electron density was maximum between the two nuclei. So this is how two sigma bonds are going to be formed when oxygen atom over here bonds with two of the hydrogen atoms on the other side. Since we have gotten some basic idea of what sigma bond are, we're going to discuss sigma bond properties now. So starting with number one, the first one, sigma bonds are formed from an end-to-end overlap of orbitals. So as you, as we just discussed in the previous examples, all the orbitals were overlapping end-to-end. The second point is that the electron density lies on the axis connecting the two nuclei. So if you go back to our example, you would notice that the electron density over here, for example, in this water molecule, it's exactly lying between the two nuclei. It's on the axis connecting the two nuclei. So it's electron density one nucleus, another nucleus. Electron density is right in the middle on the axis connecting the two nuclei. So that's my second property. And moving to the third property, which is the first bond that's formed between atoms is always a sigma bond. The rest are pi bonds. Remember, we haven't really discussed what pi bonds are. So let's keep it a little while longer. You'll understand what pi bonds are. So sigma bonds are the first bond formed between atoms. For example, hydrogen and hydrogen atoms, they bond. So that's one sigma bond that's going to be formed between the two atoms. If oxygen bonds with another oxygen, ends up forming a double bond. The first bond that's going to be formed is a sigma. The second double bond, second bond is going to be formed, is going to be a pi bond. And if you have a triple bond, for example, this molecule over here in triple bond N, the first bond is going to be a sigma bond. The rest of the bonds are going to be pi bonds. And you're going to get a lot of questions. So remember, whenever you have a single bond, that's a sigma bond. Whenever you have a double bond, it's a sigma and a pi bond. And if you have a triple bond, it's the first bond is going to be a sigma. The rest of them are going to be pi bonds. Past papers, you'll be getting a lot of questions related to counting the number of sigma and pi bonds in a molecule. So for example, in this question,
Since we haven't discussed pi bonds, so let's I'm going to just discuss sigma bonds. Zygomatic shows a molecule that has sigma and pi bonds. How many sigma bonds are present in this molecule? So you're given the structure of this molecule. What you're not given is that if you look at CH2 over here, that basically means that it's carbon, and that particular carbon is bonded to two hydrogen atoms. Then there's a CH over here, so I'm going to draw a fully displayed formula. It's bonded to one hydrogen. This carbon over here is bonded to two hydrogen. So in this way, I have now drawn a fully displayed formula where all the bonds are shown. So what is the rule? That whenever there's a single bond, it's a sigma bond. Whenever there's a double bond, that's one sigma plus one pi bond. And when there's a triple bond, there's one sigma and plus two pi. So let's start counting. That's one, two. You have a double bond, that means it's going to be one sigma plus one pi. So that's you're going to count it as one sigma because you're supposed to count sigma bonds. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Again, a double bond that has one sigma. So that's 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. Again, a double bond that's going to be counted as one sigma. So 16, 17, and 18. So your correct answer for this question is going to be you have 18 sigma bonds in this particular molecule. And they might ask you to count the number of pi bonds as well. So remember, double bond, that's one pi bond, double bond, one pi bond, double bond, one pi bond. So that's a total of three pi bonds. So you haven't really studied pi bonds yet. So sigma bonds, that's 18 in this molecule. Now the fourth property that we're going to discuss is that sigma bond rotation is possible around a sigma bond. As you've seen in the water molecule, different atoms have many different sigma bonds. For example, carbon is usually making four bonds, so it's attached to four different atoms. It's forming sigma bonds. End-to-end overlap of orbitals is happening over here, and over here. Let's for a second focus on the orbital overlap that's happening between the two carbon atoms. So there's a sigma bond that's being formed. Electron density is very high in the middle between the two carbon atoms. So the nucleus of the two carbon atoms would be attracted to the electron density over here. So they would be bonded together. They would be attracted together, mutually attracted to the shared pair of electrons over here. Now you can think of this molecule as the two carbon atoms connected together, and you can think of these other bonds that are coming out of this carbon atom. Similarly, these two carbon atoms are connected together. This carbon has other bonds coming out of it. Now what is possible is that this side of the molecule can rotate around. For example, as you can see, this hydrogen is pointing slightly downwards, so it might start pointing slightly upwards. The H might start coming out of the page, this H might go. So this part of the molecule, think of it as spokes in a wheel, in a bicycle wheel. So you have these spokes coming in, and this side of the molecule can rotate around. But nothing would happen to the sigma bond over here. The nucleus would still stay in position. The shared pair of electrons would still be there. So the attraction, the mutual attraction of the nucleus in the center and the shared electrons is going to be still there. So no matter where these bonds are pointing, that would not affect the sigma bond that's in the middle over here. Pretty much the same thing would apply to the other side. So that there's a shared pair of electrons over here. This carbon has other bonds. So these bonds could be pointing in any direction that they prefer. This side could rotate. This H is pointing downwards. It might start pointing upwards. So all the bonds over here, they could rotate around, but the nucleus is still going to stay in its position, and the shared pair of electrons and the nucleus would still attract each other. So what's going to happen is this side, all these bonds over here, they can rotate around. They can point in any direction that they want. Nothing would happen to the sigma bond over here. Let's just imagine for a moment that you had two chlorine atoms bonded to these carbon atoms. So in this molecule, the two chlorine atoms are pointing upwards. But it could also be possible that one of the chlorine atoms might be pointing upwards and the other one might get rotated downwards. So that chlorine went and got rotated downwards. But nothing happened to this particular sigma bond. So these bonds over here, they could just point in any random direction that they prefer. Nothing would happen. Nothing would change over here. So you can think of this molecule as this bond over here, the sigma bond over here, as a rod that has these spokes coming out, and these spokes can sort of rotate around, point in different directions. Nothing really matters to this sigma bond. The attraction would still be there. So rotation is possible around a sigma bond. I'll quickly discuss what are pi bonds. We have been talking about pi bonds very frequently, and we know that if there's a single bond, it has one sigma bond. Single bonds, that's one sigma bond. But when you make when you have atoms have double bonds, example this oxygen molecule over here, then there's going to be one sigma bond. The first bond is going to be a sigma, but the second bond is going to be a pi bond. And if you have a triple bond, then this is a triple bond N, then the first one would be a sigma, and the rest of the two bonds are going to be pi bonds. So pi bonds are usually occurring when there's a double bond or a triple bond. So you don't have pi bonds when you have single bonds. So I'm going to discuss the case of oxygen, and I'm going to explain to you how pi bonds are formed. So let's try and figure out how the oxygen atoms are bonded to each other. So these are my two oxygen atoms, and the electronic configuration is written. As you can see, oxygen needs two electrons. It's two of the orbitals, two of the p orbitals, py and pz. They need electrons. So one electron needs to go in the 2py and one electron needs to go into the 2pz orbital. And the other oxygen atom also has identical two orbitals. Both of them would need two electrons. So I'm going to ignore the other orbitals because they're completely full. We're not going to draw them. And I'm going to draw the molecule of oxygen. An oxygen atom bonding, trying to bond with another oxygen atom. So it's the 2py and the 2pz trying to fill themselves up. So I'm just going to draw the 2py and 2pz orbitals for oxygen. This is one of the oxygen atoms. It's 2py and 2pz orbitals are drawn. So it has one electron in the, let's call this the 2pz. This 2pz orbital over here, let's call this 2pz. So this is the 2pz orbital. Has one electron. It needs another electron in that orbital. And then let's call this the 2py orbital. Remember, xyz axes are arbitrarily assigned. In three-dimensional space, there is no x, y, and z. The labeling is done by you. So I'm just calling this the y-axis. So this is my 2py orbital. And there's one electron in the 2py orbital. So an electron somewhere in this area, in this p orbital, in the two lobes. And there's one electron in this 2pz orbital over here. Here's the other oxygen atom, the nucleus, and the 2pz. And the 2py orbitals are shown. So let's focus first on this blue orbitals over here. Let's focus on the 2py orbitals. So this 2py orbital needs an electron. So it's going to see the other oxygen atom's 2py orbital. It's going to try and pull that electron, and it's going to try and gain that electron. So the 2py of one oxygen is going to attract the electron from the 2py from the other oxygen atom. But there's going to be mutual attraction. This atom also needs an electron in its 2py, so it's going to try and pull the other oxygen atom's electron towards it. So the electron density would be maximum somewhere in the middle. So the electron density would be maximum. The two electrons are going to be stuck in this middle part over here. Both atoms, this oxygen atom, they're trying to pull the electron, so the electrons are stuck somewhere in the middle. And there would be lesser probability of the electron going to the other side. So I'm going to shrink these orbitals on, or these lobes on the outer side. So these outer lobes have been shrunk, and this inner would be orbital. The two orbitals overlapping, that would be my sigma bond. So that's the first bond. That's my sigma bond that's being formed over here. So the first bond, remember, is always going to be a sigma bond. So the two atoms, their orbitals, the 2py overlapping with the 2py, both atoms trying to attract each other's electrons. Electrons density increases in the middle on the axis. So this is a sigma bond. Now let's move to and let's discuss the second bond that's going to be formed, is going to be a pi bond. And how would a pi bond form? So a pi bond is going to be formed when the 2pz orbitals, they start overlapping. Because remember, oxygen had another orbital 2pz. It had one electron. It needed one electron. So this orbital over here needs one electron. The other oxygen atom also has a 2pz. It needs one electron. So they're going to start mutually attracting each other's electrons. So this electron will get attracted by the other oxygen atom. The other oxygen atom, remember, the electron is going to be spread out around the p orbital. So the electron, this atom over here is going to try and attract the electron from this oxygen atom. It's going to try and attract the electron in the 2pz orbital. This oxygen atom is going to do exactly the same. It's going to try and pull the electron over here. It's going to try and gain an electron from the other atom's 2pz orbital. So they're going to mutually start attracting each other's electrons. Because this one needs one electron, this one also needs electron. So this one, this orbital over here, tries to gain the other oxygen atom's electron. The other oxygen atom is going to try and gain the first oxygen atom's electron. One thing that you would notice is that the orbitals are now in parallel. They are parallel to each other. So that is one condition that when pi bonds are formed, the orbitals are, instead of an end-to-end overlap, as can be seen in a sigma bond, these orbitals are lying parallel to each other. And if they start overlapping, the electron density would then be on top. The two orbitals are going to merge and the electron density would be maximum. So the electron density would be stuck, the electrons would be stuck somewhere in this middle area. They're going to form a pi bond. The electrons in this orbital and the electron in this orbital, they're going to merge with each other. Both atoms would try to attract each other's electrons. So the electron density, like a sigma bond, it's going to become maximum in the middle. But it would be on the axis connecting the two nuclei. It's going to be above the axis and below the axis, because that middle part is already occupied by electrons, so that space is not available. So the two orbitals are going to merge. The electron densities of that merging is going to lie above and below the axis connecting the two nuclei. So let's draw a neater version of this diagram that I've drawn over here. Quickly summarizing what we just did, you have two oxygen atoms, 2PY, 2PZ need electrons. The other oxygen atom again, 2PY, 2PZ need electrons. So this is my 2PY and 2PY electrons over here. Both oxygen atoms, they mutually attract each other's electrons. So the electron density increases somewhere in the middle. The two electrons are going to be found somewhere in the middle, and the electron density on the right and left side of the lobes, that's going to decrease. So that's your sigma bond that's going to be formed, because there's going to be an end-to-end overlap of orbitals. Whereas this other bond over here, this one is your 2PZ. One electron in this, one electron in this. Both atoms are going to try gain each other's electrons. So the one of the oxygen atom over here is going to try and fill its orbital 2PZ by gaining the electron from the other oxygen atom, and it's going to try and pull the electrons from the first one. This oxygen atom also wants an electron over here, so it's going to try and pull the other oxygen atom's electron towards it. Eventually, the electron cloud is going to merge on top and below, and that's going to be your pi bond. This entire thing, this blue bonding orbital, is your pi bond, because these two orbitals in parallel, they have merged, and the electron density lies above and below the axis connecting the two nuclei. So there's a sigma bond, and then there is your pi bond. Next time, whenever you see a double bond, for example, oxygen double bond oxygen, you should know what's happening over here. There's a sigma bond, electron density in the middle, and then there's a pi bond, the electron density is above and below the axis connecting the two nuclei. So the first bond is going to be a sigma bond between the two atoms, and then there's going to be an overlap of orbitals above and below the axis connecting the two nuclei. So we are done with pi bonds, so let's quickly discuss a few properties of pi bonds and which are associated with them. The first point is that orbitals are overlapping in parallel, which means it's not an end-to-end overlap, it's a parallel overlap of orbitals. The second point is that electron density lies above and below the axis connecting the two nuclei, as we had shown you in this example over here. In a pi bond, electron density is not in the middle between the two nuclei, it's above and below the axis that is connecting the two nuclei. So that's your second point. Third point, which we have already previously discussed on many occasions, that is that single bond, that's sigma. If you have a double bond, that's one sigma, the other one must be a pi, and if you have a triple bond, then you have one sigma and two pi bonds. Last, the fourth point is that rotation is not possible around a pi bond. So whenever you have a pi bond, independent rotation is not going to be possible. So I'm going to give you an example first. Let's have a look at this dichloroethene molecule, where you have a carbon but forming a double bond with another carbon atom. So as you already know what's happening over here when there's a double bond, that's one sigma and one pi bond. So let me draw that now. So let's say this is your sigma bond. I've drawn the molecule. I'm opening up this double bond, trying to figure out how the electrons are going to be arranged. So there's a sigma bond, electron density is right in the middle. And then there's a pi bond. And as we have already studied, how are pi bonds formed? Pi bonds are formed when you have two orbitals that are parallel to each other, and they start overlapping above and below, the electron densities merge. So there's a sigma bond in the middle, and then there's a pi bond over here, a pi electron cloud. on top and below this bond. So there's sigma bond plus this pi bond, that's two bonds. So that's your double bond that we have discussed so far. So now coming back to the rotation part, what that basically means is we did rotation in sigma bonds as well. But when you have a pi bond, the molecule is locked in position, which basically means that independent rotation is not possible. You can't force or you can't spin this H. Think of this carbon atom with these extra bonds coming out of it. The double bond was between the two carbon atoms. So think of these other bonds that are coming out of this as spokes on a wheel. And there's this carbon, they're connected to this carbon over here. This carbon cannot rotate because if it rotates, this parallel overlapping is going to break, which means that this H, if it's pointing upwards, and the Cl, if it's pointing downwards, they're going to remain pointed downwards because you can't sort of switch them around. You can't rotate this carbon atom because if it rotates, this P orbital over here is also going to rotate. And if it rotates, this P orbital is locked in position with its neighboring P orbital over here. So this P orbital cannot rotate independently. This carbon cannot rotate independently. These spokes or these bonds that are coming out of this carbon atom, they cannot rotate independently. In sigma bonds, that was not an issue because if this parallel overlapping is finished, if it's not present, then this side and this side are free to rotate around. These bonds are free to point in any direction they find suitable. But with these pi electron cloud, these pi bonds, it's impossible to actually rotate this side of the molecule independently. So next time, whenever you see a molecule, for example, this molecule over here, remember these bonds over here, they are locked in position. You can't change them. You can't independently rotate this side. You can't make this H, if it's pointing upwards, you can't make it point downwards because it's locked in position. There's a double bond over here, which means that there's a pi electron cloud, a pi orbital or a pi bond that's forming between the two carbon atoms. If you try to rotate or switch, you can't rotate this carbon atom because the p orbital would also rotate with it, and the overlapping with the neighboring carbon's p orbital, it's going to break. So this side, the blue ones that I've shown, they can't move around, they can't rotate independently at least. But when you have a sigma bond, for example, this one is a sigma bond. All these atoms over here, they can rotate around. The Cl could be pointing this side. It could also be pointing the other side. The Cls could rotate around. This carbon can freely rotate around. Its sigma bond is not going to break. The nucleus can rotate around. It would still be attracted to the shared pair of electrons in this sigma bond. So when you have a single bond, the spokes or the other bonds that are coming out, they could be pointing in any direction. They could be rotating around just like the spokes on a wheel. They're connected to that carbon atom. This carbon atom can rotate around, but when there's a double bond, then this carbon atom is going to be geometrically aligned with this carbon atom. The two orbitals would be in parallel, so this carbon atom cannot independently just rotate or point its orbitals in any direction because its orbitals would be pointing in a very fixed direction where they would be in parallel to the neighboring carbon atom's p orbital, so they can't independently rotate around. Let's now try and do another example involving sigma and pi bonds, and this time I'm picking into molecule because it has a triple bond. So I'm going to just show you how a triple bond is going to be formed. So in an N2 molecule, it's basically two nitrons trying to bond with each other. And you have, if you look at the nitrons electronic configuration, it has seven electrons. So that's 2px, 2py, 2pz, all three needing an electron. So these orbitals over here, they need electrons. So it wants to fill up its 2px, 2py, and 2pz orbitals. The other nitrogen is also going to try and do exactly the same. It has the same electronic configuration. So it's going to try and fill up its 2px, 2py, and 2pz orbitals with electrons. Thing is, this type of question can never be asked in CIE because it's a three-dimensional diagram. It's very hard to actually draw any three-dimensional diagrams. But we're going to try. So these are your two nitrogen atoms. Nitrogen has, remember, we're ignoring the full orbitals. They are not going to be involved in bonding. Let's look at 2px, 2py, and 2pz. So let's see all the orbitals first. So let's start with 2px. 2px, 2px of the two nitrogen atoms trying to overlap with each other. And let's call this the x-axis. So there's an orbital over here. And then there's an orbital over here. Both have one electron. They attract each other's electron. So the electron density becomes maximum in this middle area. And they end up forming a sigma bond right in the middle. So there's an end-to-end overlap. That's the first bond that's going to be formed. And that's going to be a sigma bond. So this orange one over here, that's your sigma bond. That's the first bond that's going to be formed. And let me write that over here. That's your sigma bond. Now let's focus on, let's say, the 2PY orbitals. The 2PY orbitals are going to overlap with each other. So there's an electron. This is this over here that I'm shading. That's my 2PY. And that's the other nitrogen atom's 2PY orbitals. And they're going to be in parallel because if this is the x-axis, the y-axis would be vertical. So they're in parallel now. And if they are in parallel, they're going to start overlapping above and below the axis connecting. So they start overlapping above and below. So this over here is probably going to be the pi bond that's going to be formed above and below. So that's your pi bond. That's your first pi bond that's going to be formed. So you already had one sigma bond, orbitals overlapping in the middle. Now, 2PY and 2PY orbitals in parallel, they're going to overlap with each other, and they're going to form a pi bond. So that's your second bond that's being formed. That's your pi bond. And then comes the turn for 2PZ. So 2PZ, both of them, need electrons. So 2PZ would be on the Z-axis. So this shaded area over here, think of it as three-dimensional. They're coming out of the page, going into the page. They're in the third dimension, the Z-axis. So there's an electron over here, and they're on the Z-axis, but they're in parallel as well. There's an electron over here. This 2PZ needs an electron. The other 2PZ also needs an electron. So they're going to try and attract each other's electrons. So they're going to start overlapping on this plane that's coming out of the page and going into the page. So that's going to be your other pi bond. So you had a sigma bond end-to-end overlap of 2PX with 2PX. Then the 2PY and the 2PY started overlapping and they formed another pi bond. And then the 2PZ and the 2PZ, they were also in parallel. They started overlapping and they ended up forming a pi bond as well. So this particular bond over here that you can sort of see, it's in the third plane. It's in the third dimension. Its orbitals are pointing in the Z direction. So they're overlapping above and below. So you had a sigma bond in the middle, an overlap of electrons above and below the axis, and an overlap of electrons in front and behind. So that's your triple bond that's going to be formed when 2px overlaps with 2px, forming a sigma bond, 2py overlaps with a 2py, forming a pi bond, and 2pz overlapping with another 2pz, forming another pi bond. So two pi bonds and just one sigma bond. Next topic that would be related to sigma and pi bonds that we're going to study is the hybridization of carbon. Now, the meaning of orbital hybridization is that is the concept of mixing of atomic orbitals to form new hybrid orbitals, which are going to have different angles, different energies, different shapes than the component atomic orbitals, suitable for pairing of electrons to form chemical bonds. So it usually happens when bond formation is happening. And I'm going to explain this in very simple terms, what all of this basically means. So over here, I've brought you back to sigma bonds and how sigma bonds were formed. So what basically orbital hybridization means is that when two orbitals are bonding with each other and they start overlapping, the bonding orbital is going to have a completely different shape. The p orbitals are going to be pulled in different directions. The s orbitals would be pulled in different directions. So orbitals are going to change shape when they are bonding. They're not going to remain exactly the same as they were before. As you can see over here, two p orbitals, they merge and they form this shape of p of a bonding orbital. So that pretty much is what hybridization is, that whenever two atoms are bonding to each other. So here's another example of the HF sigma bond. You had a p orbital from F, it was overlapping with an s orbital from hydrogen, and they started attracting each other, and eventually you got a bonding orbital which had a completely different shape. So orbitals are going to change shape, they're going to change angles, so different things are going to happen to orbitals when they are bonding. They're going to be stretched in different directions. So let's see what happens in hybridization.
Now, one thing about A-level syllabus is that hybridization is limited to carbon. So we just need to discuss what happens to carbon. So as you already know that carbon's electronic configuration, carbon has 6 electrons. And this over here is its electronic configuration, 1s2, 2s2, 2px1, 2py1 and 2pz0. So this is its electronic configuration. And let's focus on the outer shell first. So this is what carbon is going to look like when it is in its lowest energy ground state. I'm going to ignore the inner shell. Let's not talk about it because inner shell electrons, they're not going to be involved in bonding. It's only the outer shell electrons that are going to be involved when chemical bonds are going to be formed. If you look over here, you would notice that there are a total of 4 electrons and there are a total of 4 orbitals. So 4 orbitals, 4 electrons, but remember that the ground state electronic configuration is pretty different. There's one orbital which is completely empty, and then there's another orbital which has 2 electrons in it. Now, from what we know about carbon, we know that carbon is usually making 4 bonds, especially when it's sp3 hybridized. So let's talk about sp3 hybridization. So sp3 hybridization is occurring when carbon is making 4 single bonds or sigma bonds. An example could be CH4. In CH4, carbon is making 4 single bonds with 4 hydrogens. Now I'm going to explain to you what's going to happen and what type of hybridization would happen. What would happen to the shape of these 4 orbitals. So initially think of carbon like this. This is the ground state of carbon. As you can see, there are 2 electrons in an s orbital, so 2 electrons are together. There's 1 electron in one orbital, there's another electron in another orbital, and there's 1 orbital that is completely empty. Now imagine, we already know that carbon makes 4 bonds with hydrogen. We know that the formula is CH4. So if there are 4 hydrogen atoms present around carbon, and remember, if you remember clearly, hydrogen needs just 1 electron. It has an s orbital with 1 electron in it, so it needs 1 electron. As you can see over here, each of the hydrogen atom is going to try and pull one of the electrons from carbon's outer shell. So there are 4 electrons, 4 orbitals. One of them is empty, one is completely full. So you can see that the hydrogens, each hydrogen is trying to pull an orbital, an electron, towards it. So what's going to happen to this orbital over here, which had 2 electrons in it? One electron would split, this orbital would split. One electron would go to one hydrogen atom, the other one would go to the other hydrogen atom. So it's going to split in the middle, and instead, so what basically happens is, that instead of having 2 electrons in one orbital, one of the electrons is going to move from this position, and it's going to occupy the 2pz orbital now. So now, this carbon is going to have 4 separate orbitals. Each orbital will have a separate electron. So instead of having 2 electrons in the same place, you had 4 orbitals and you had 4 electrons. So each orbital is going to have just 1 electron. So one electron gets attracted to one hydrogen, the other electron gets attracted to the other hydrogen, the third electron or orbital gets attracted to the third hydrogen, and so on. So 4 electrons are going to occupy 4 different separate orbitals, and they're going to distribute themselves so to maximize bond formation. Previously, when we were discussing sigma and pi bonds, you already know that electrons are going to get stretched or pulled in different direction when bonding is happening. So for example, there's a nucleus of hydrogen over here. S orbital is spherical, so the electron would probably be in a spherical region. P orbital is double shaped, PY is also double shaped, and PZ is also double shaped. But when this carbon atom is bonding with 4 of the hydrogen atoms, one of the electron is going to be attracted to one of the hydrogen atoms. So that orbital, whatever the orbital, but remember carbon had these 4 orbitals, 4 outer shell orbitals. So I'm not really concerned with which one. But one of the orbitals is going to be pulled towards hydrogen. Then there's going to be another hydrogen attracting another electron. So one of carbon's electron in one of the orbitals is going to be pulled towards that particular hydrogen atom. And this would repeat with all the other 2 orbitals. Another electron of carbon is going to be pulled by one of the other hydrogen, the third hydrogen. And the fourth electron of carbon is going to be pulled in a separate direction. So all the orbitals are going to get stretched in different directions, which is why they're going to change shape. And if they change shape, you wouldn't be able to call them an s orbital. You wouldn't be able to call them a px orbital or a py or a pz. And the reason for that is,
That the shape would be different. An S refers to a spherical orbital, but there would not be any spherical orbital because the electron has been pulled and the orbital has been stretched in one direction because of the nucleus. The attractive forces of the nucleus of hydrogen that is exerting a force. The same is true for the other orbitals, so they're going to be stretched in different directions. So you would have to give them different names. Remember, P, you can't call them P because P had a specific, very specific shape. So what's going to happen now is that you would start calling them different names now. And the name that is assigned to these orbitals, these hybrid orbitals now, is they're called sp3 hybrid orbitals. The reason they're given the same name is because they look identical. One electron getting stretched to one direction, the other orbital getting stretched in another direction. So they look very identical. So the name is going to be the same for all the four orbitals. And the shape is important. If you look at this shape, this arrangement, it's a tetrahedral arrangement. All the bond angles are going to be 109.5 degrees. So four orbitals getting stretched in different directions, bond angles 109.5 degrees. So next time, whenever you see a carbon atom that's making four single bonds or four sigma bonds, like the example of CH4, always remember that sp3 hybridization is happening. Carbon has four outer orbitals and the electrons, they get stretched in different directions, forming four orbitals of different shaped. They call sp3 now. So all of them, they get different names. All of the four orbitals would be called sp3. They would be your bonding orbitals. They would go and bond with the other atoms around carbon. For example, in this case, they would bond with hydrogen atoms. Let's now move to the other type of hybridization, which is called sp2 hybridization. This happens when carbon is bonded to three atoms. You can say that carbon makes three sigma bonds plus one pi bond, which basically means there's one double bond involved. So an example of carbon making is bonding to three atoms would be, you can look at this ethene molecule over here. You can notice this carbon atom in green. It's bonded to three atoms. So on three sides, there's just three atoms, which means it's making three sigma bonds, and there's a pi bond over here as well. This carbon is also going to be sp2 hybridized because it's bonded to three atoms. Unlike the previous case when carbon was bonded to four atoms, it was making four single bonds. In this case, carbon would be making a double bond, at least one double bond. Over here, this carbon is also sp2 hybridized. Let's write sp2 next to it. It's bonded to three atoms. Not this carbon atom. This carbon atom is making four single bonds. So this is the sp3 hybridization that we just discussed. So you should be able to identify which of the carbons are going to be sp2 hybridized. Now let's discuss what sp2 hybridization really is. Remember, as we have discussed previously, carbon had four outer orbitals. Each one needed an electron, so four orbitals were involved in bond formation. Now, in sp2 hybridization, carbon has four electrons, but they're only three atoms. Only three atoms are around carbon, which means initially, only three of the electrons. One of the electrons would be attracted to one of the atoms. The other electron would be attracted to atom number two. The third electron would be attracted to atom number three. The fourth electron is initially not going to be attracted to any of the atoms. So what's going to happen is only three of the orbitals, they are going to stretch and they're going to be pulled in different direction. One atom attracting one of the electrons from an orbital, the other atom attracting the other orbital and its electron, and the third atom attracting the third orbital and its electron. So only three of the orbitals are going to change, they're going to stretch, whereas the fourth orbital remains completely unchanged initially. So let me try and draw this sp2 hybridization. So here's a better picture of what happened over here. This over here, three of the orbitals, one orbital getting stretched, its electron density getting pulled towards atom number one, electron density getting pulled to atom number two, let's call that 2px orbital, that's getting stretched, and the third one is getting attracted to atom number three. Now since all three have changed shape, you can't call them an s or a p orbital because now the shape is completely different. So S is spherical, P is dumbbell-shaped, but these orbitals are no longer spherical or dumbbell-shaped. So you're going to give them different names. You're going to start calling them sp2 hybrid orbitals. So that would be their new names. Instead of calling them 2s, 2px, 2py, you would start calling them sp2 So this is a sp2 hybrid orbital. This one is also now an sp2 hybrid orbital, and the third one is also an sp2 hybrid orbital. Now remember, don't focus too much on the name. It simply means that the orbital has changed shape. So it's still the same orbital, but the shape is different, which is why I would stop calling it an S orbital. I would stop calling it a PX orbital or a PY orbital. I would instead start calling them with the new name, which is going to be SP2, SP2, and SP2. And the reason why the name is always the same for the three, why I've given them the same name, is that they look exactly the same. You'll be asked a lot about SP2 arrangements. So remember, the arrangement is going to be trigonal planar or fan-shaped. All the bonds, they would be arranged in a fan-shaped manner. So think of a fan with three blades, and so there would be 120 degree angles between the three orbitals, between the three hybrid SP2 orbitals. So this is about SP2 hybridization. But one thing we missed out, and that is that one of the orbitals of carbon is not bonding initially with anything, which means that one of the orbital remains completely unchanged. So this over here, it remains completely unchanged. This over here is the unchanged p orbital, which initially hasn't undergone any changes. So that would be the shape of a carbon atom and its orbitals when it is sp2 hybridized. It's bonded to three atoms. Three orbitals get pulled or stretched in different directions, whereas the fourth orbital remains completely unchanged. Now the next step is I'm going to show you how carbon is going to bond. So for example, an ethene molecule. Let's try and draw what an ethene molecule looks like, and keeping this shape in mind. So we're going to keep this shape in mind, and we're going to figure out what an ethene molecule or how the bonding in ethene is going to look like. So this here is my ethene molecule, and as you can see, let's focus on the first carbon atom over here. I'm putting a star on it. What's happening to that? It's bonded to three atoms, which means three of its electron orbitals are going to be pulled in different directions for bonding purposes. So let's say these arrows represent these orbitals over here getting pulled, and they're forming sigma bonds, sigma covalent bonds with the neighboring atoms. On this side, again, this over here, this carbon atom over here is identical. It's also bonded to three atoms. So again, it's one of the hydrogen is going to pull its orbital towards it. The other hydrogen is going to do the exact same thing. And on the left, there's going to be carbon that would be pulling its electron cloud. So in the middle over here, the electron clouds are going to overlap, and the two carbon atoms, they would end up forming a sigma bond over here as well. So this is what's happening. These three orbitals, one got pulled, bonded with carbon, the other bonded, got stretched, bonded with hydrogen, the third one bonded with hydrogen. And the same for this carbon atom. One orbital got attracted to hydrogen, the other one got attracted to the other hydrogen, and the third one ended up overlapping with this carbon's orbital, and it ended up forming sigma bonds. So these sp2, sp2, sp2 are overlapping to form sigma bonds. Now the question is, what happens to this unused p orbital initially that wasn't undergoing any changes? So let's bring in the unused p orbital. There's going to be a p orbital that would be present over there, but because there is no fourth atom, that p orbital initially is going to be unused. So let's bring in the unused p orbital. So as you can see, these are my unused p orbital, and as you can see, when two orbitals, they become parallel to each other and they are half filled, which means this orbital over here, if you remember, all of carbon's orbital just had one electron. So this orbital needs one electron, so it's going to try and pull the electrons from the neighboring p orbital, which is in parallel. The same would happen with this p orbital. This needed one electron, so it's going to try and pull or attract the electron from the neighboring or the orbital that is next door, parallel to each other. So they're both parallel to each other, and they would start overlapping. They would end up forming a pi electron cloud above and below, and these two orbitals are going to merge, and the electron density would be maximum somewhere in the middle. So there's going to be a sigma bond in the center, and a pi bond would be formed by this unused p orbital. This unused p orbital is always involved in pi bonding because it would be parallel to other p orbitals,
and it would help in the formation of pi bonds, which is why there's going to be a double bond over here between the two carbon atoms, because a p orbital unused of this carbon atom and a p orbital unused of this carbon atom, they're going to overlap to form this second bond. The second bond, the first one was the sigma bond, where the electron cloud was overlapping end to end, and this one would be your pi bond. This is your summary of sp2 hybridization. Carbon was bonded to three atoms, got pulled in different directions, so they changed shape and they became sp2 hybrid orbitals, whereas the fourth orbital remained completely unchanged. And when it's bonding forming a molecule of ethene, what it's going to do is two of the sp2 hybrid orbitals are going to overlap, and they're going to form a sigma bond. Then an sp2 orbital would be attracted, stretched by one of the hydrogen atoms. They're going to form a sigma bond over here. Over here, there's going to be a sigma bond. And there's going to be a fourth unused p orbital. The same would be true for this carbon atom. Three of the electron orbitals are going to be pulled in different directions, and they're going to form sigma bonds in three directions. There's going to be an end-to-end overlap. And in the very end, these unused p orbitals, they come parallel to each other, and they end up overlapping above and below. So they're going to start overlapping above and below the axis connecting the two nuclei, and they would end up forming a pi bond in that place. So what you must remember is that the sigma bonds are being formed by the sp2 hybrid orbitals, whereas the pi bond over here is formed when a p and a p orbital overlap with each other. So sigma bonds formed by the unused by the sp2 hybrid orbitals, whereas the pi bonds are being formed by the p orbitals. Last type of hybridization that we're going to discuss is called sp hybridization. That would happen in carbon as well. And remember, we're only focusing on carbon. We're not discussing other atoms. Hybridization is a process that happens in all atoms, but we're only going to discuss carbon over here. This hybridization occurs when carbon is only bonded to two atoms, or when carbon is making two sigma bonds and it's making two pi bonds. So when carbon makes two sigma, two pi bonds, that is when carbon would be sp hybridized. Some examples for this could be carbon dioxide, CO2 molecule. The carbon is only bonded to two atoms, two oxygen atoms on both sides. It's making two sigma bonds, one over here, and two pi bonds, one over here and one over here. The same is also true for an HCN molecule. Carbon is only bonded to two atoms, so it's making two bonds. Two sigma bonds, one over here, and there would be two pi bonds over here as well. In starting from scratch, you already know that carbon has four outer shell electrons in four orbitals, 2s1, 2px1, 2py1, 2pz1. So all these orbitals, they need electrons. They're going to try and bond with other atoms. But in this case, carbon is only bonded to two atoms. So let's take the example of a CO2 molecule. So this is what initially is going to happen. There are only two atoms. So one of the orbitals is going to be pulled, and it's going to be stretched. Its electron is going to be pulled by one of the oxygen atoms to the right. The other orbital with its electron is going to be pulled towards the oxygen on the left. And what would initially happen to these two orbitals? Nothing would happen because there are no other atoms. There are only two atoms. So one oxygen atom pulling an orbital in this direction, the other oxygen atom pulling an orbital in this direction, whereas the other two orbitals, they would remain initially unchanged. So these are your two unchanged p orbitals. There's a 2py orbital on the y-axis and a 2pz orbital with its electron on the z-axis. Remember, these two orbitals also need an electron, so they would eventually be used in bonding as well, but initially right now they're not involved in bonding. So this is what carbon would look like when it's sp hybridized. It's bonded to two oxygen, two atoms. So one electron gets pulled in one direction, the other electron gets pulled in the other direction. Two of the orbitals, they remain completely unchanged. Let's also briefly discuss what actually happens to these unused p orbitals. I would start calling these two orbitals that have changed shape, I would start calling them my sp2 orbitals, because they have now changed shape. They've now gotten stretched by one of the oxygen atoms to the right and one on the left. So I would start calling them sp2 orbitals instead of calling them 2s or 2px, whereas the other two orbitals, they would remain initially unchanged. Now, what would happen to these two orbitals? They would be involved in pi bonding, because if you look at oxygen's electronic configuration, you're going to notice that oxygen has two orbitals that need electrons. So one of the oxygen's orbital is going to be attracted by the carbon atom, and they're going to
overlap end-to-end. The sp2 from carbon is going to overlap with one of the orbitals from oxygen, and they're going to pull each other's electron, and the electron density would be maximum in the middle. Oxygen has another orbital, which is 2pz. So initially that 2pz is not going to be involved in bonding. So here's your 2pz orbital, which is initially not involved in bonding. The two atoms are going to get close together, the overlapping in the middle, the sigma bond that's being formed over here, it's going to become stronger and stronger. And as you can see, carbon's unused p orbital and oxygen's other orbital, they are now in parallel. If they're in parallel, they would start overlapping. They both need electrons, so they would start overlapping with each other. And the electron density would become maximum in the center somewhere. So that would result in the formation of a pi bond. So there was a sigma bond being formed when the sp2 carbon hybridized orbital got stretched and got attracted to oxygen and overlapped with oxygen's orbital. Whereas the other orbitals, the unused orbitals, they would start overlapping with each other. Pretty much the same thing would happen with this oxygen atom. Again, remember that oxygen had 2py and 2pz orbitals. So one of the orbitals would get attracted to the carbon atom next door, and they would end up forming a sigma bond. Whereas there's going to be an unused another p orbital for oxygen, and let's draw that p orbital on this axis, the z axis, so that it becomes parallel to and the two atoms would attract each other. The sigma bond overlapping in the middle would become stronger, so the overlap would increase, and the sp2 of this carbon atom would be attracted to oxygen's orbital, and they would overlap. But these two orbitals would now become parallel to each other. One of carbon's unused p orbital and one of oxygen's p orbital, they would become parallel to each other. And if they become parallel to each other, they would start overlapping with each other. They would start attracting each other's electrons. So the electron density would be maximum somewhere in the middle, and they would end up forming a pi electron cloud, or a pi bond would be formed. But as you can see, this pi bond is in a different plane. Compared to the p orbital overlap, or the pi bond that's being formed on the right side. So the planes are going to be different, but there's going to be a pi bond over here, and there's going to be a pi bond on the left as well. So the unused p orbitals would be involved in the formation of two pi bonds. So let's quickly do another example for an ethyne molecule, and I'll show you how sp hybridization would occur in that. So this is what an ethyne molecule looks like. As you can see, carbon is bonded to two atoms. So this carbon is going to be sp hybridized, and this carbon over here would also be sp hybridized because it's bonded to two atoms, and each of the carbon atoms is forming two sigma bonds, one over here, and two pi bonds. So this carbon atom is forming two pi bonds over here. So it's going to be sp hybridization, and let's quickly see what's going to happen. So this is how the two carbon atoms are going to look like. If you look, focus on this carbon atom, one electron is getting pulled by hydrogen over here. The other electron is getting pulled by carbon on this side. So there must be a hydrogen atom over here that's pulling one of the orbitals. The other orbital is getting pulled by this other carbon atom over here. So this electron is getting pulled by the carbon on the left side. Two of the orbitals are going to remain completely unchanged. So what's going to happen, the same would be true for this carbon atom over here. Over here, there's going to be a hydrogen atom that's pulling one of the orbitals, and the other electron is getting pulled by the neighboring carbon atom. So they're going to overlap in the middle, and they're going to form a sigma bond right in the middle. So that's where your sigma bond is going to be formed. And they're going to be two sigma bonds formed on the right side with hydrogen, and on the left side. So carbon had four orbitals. One got attracted over here. One got attracted over here. Two of the orbitals remain completely unchanged. This carbon atom, exactly the same. Four orbitals, four electrons. One got attracted to this side. The other got attracted to this hydrogen over here. Two of the orbitals remain completely unchanged. So what would the two unchanged orbitals do? They are in parallel to each other. If they are in parallel to each other, they would start overlapping. So the red ones, they would start overlapping with each other, and they would form a pi bond. So that's your first pi bond that's being formed. And the orange ones would also overlap with each other, and they would form pi bonds as well. Remember, the plane is going to be different. One orbital would be, let's say, on the y-axis, so they're overlapping above and below. The other ones are on the z-axis, so think of them as coming out of the page and going into the page. This pretty much sums it up. The SPSP overlap is the sigma bond, and the PNP overlap and the PNP overlap, that they are forming your two pi bonds. So they're going to be two pi bonds that are going to be formed in this molecule, which is going to result in the formation of a triple bond in the middle.
The exam questions, the most important exam questions that are going to be thrown at you, you'll be asked to learn to identify the type of hybridization in a particular molecule, especially related to carbon. So for example, if this molecule is given to you and you'll be asked to figure out or identify the type of hybridization, let's start with the first one. Over here, this carbon atom, it's making four bonds. So if it's making four single bonds, then this carbon is going to be sp3 hybridized. So any carbon atom that's making four single bonds, again this one, this would be sp3 hybridized as well. And then this carbon atom is also making four bonds, so it's going to be sp3 hybridized, which means it's going to be tetrahedral, and all the bond angles are going to be 109.5 degrees. So this is what you'll be frequently asked to identify. If you look at this carbon atom over here, it's bonded to three atoms, which means it's making one double bond. It's making one pi bond and three sigma bonds. So this carbon atom over here will be sp2 hybridized. It's going to be sp2 hybridized, and there's going to be an unchanged p orbital, which would be forming a pi bond or would be overlapping with the neighboring oxygen's p orbital, and it would form a pi electron cloud. So this is sp2 hybridized, and similarly, if you look at this carbon atom over here, this carbon atom is only bonded to two atoms, which means it's making a sigma bond and another sigma bond, two sigma bonds, and there are two pi bonds over here. So this one is going to be sp hybridized. So you must know what type of hybridization is happening in a particular molecule. Now let's quickly move to another subtopic, which is shapes of molecules, which would be related to bonding, and it would have an effect on bonding. And we've done a little bit of shapes of molecules when we were talking about sp3, sp2 and sp hybridization. Now, shapes of molecules is determined by a theory which is known as the valence shell electron pair repulsion theory, or in short, it's known as VSEPR. The theory basically states that any bonds in the valence shell or lone pairs, they're going to be repelling each other. For example, if you have a CO2 molecule, now carbon is forming a double bond with an oxygen atom, and it's forming a double bond with another oxygen atom. So the electrons over here and the electrons over here. Focus on the valence shell. The shape of the molecule only depends on what the valence shell electrons are doing. The other electrons are inside or closer to the nucleus, so they're not the ones that are determining the shape of the molecule. So the idea is that these electrons over here and the electrons over here, they're going to be repelling each other. So the valence shell electrons, the bonded electrons, they're going to be repelling each other. Electrons over here, bunch of electrons over here, they're both repelling each other. So the shape of the molecule would be determined by this repulsion. The molecule is going to try and minimize the force of repulsion. So if you have a double bond on this side, the other double bond is going to get repelled, and it would be on the complete opposite side. So the angle between the two bonds is going to be 180 degrees. If you have another molecule, for example, AlCl3, this molecule has three bonds. Three bonding pairs of electrons, electrons over here, electrons over here, electrons over here. So all those electrons would be repelling each other. So these bonds, bonded electrons would be repelling each other. These bonded electrons would also be repelling each other. So there's going to be repulsion between these bonded electrons. So the shape of this molecule is going to be like a fan. All the bonds, they would be pointing in complete opposite direction, and they would be making an angle of 120 degrees. So it's going to look, it's going to have a fan-shaped arrangement. One CL over here, one CL over here, the other CL repelled by the other two, and it's pointing in the opposite direction. So all these bonds, they would be completely repelling each other. So these bonded pair of electrons are going to be repelling each other, but it's not, the valence shell is not only just going to have bonded pairs of electrons. So for example, you have a molecule of SO2. So here's your SO2 molecule. Sulfur is forming double bonds with oxygen and another oxygen over here. Remember, it's always the middle atom that's going to be determining the shape of the molecule, not the atoms, the terminal atoms. So always focus when you're trying to figure out the shape, focus on the middle atom over here. Now, the problem in this case is going to be sulfur is in group 6. So in group 6, it's going to have, if it's in group 6, it's going to have 6 electrons in its outer shell. So 2 electrons have been shared over here. 2 electrons have been shared over here. That means there are 2 electrons left in the outer shell. So these are called your lone pairs. These are the unused orbitals or electrons that are present in the outer shell, valence shell of an atom. So sulfur, 6 electrons, 2 got bonded with oxygen, 2 got bonded with another oxygen, and 2 electrons are left. Now, so it's not just repulsion between this bonded electrons and these bonded electrons. It's you have to consider these lone pairs as well. These lone pairs are going to be exerting a force of repulsion as well. So the presence of this lone pair over here is going to push or repel those two bonds, and what would eventually happen is that this molecule is going to look something like this. So it's going to have a kind of a bent shape. The lone pairs are pushing the electrons downwards, so both bonds, they got repelled downwards. Unlike in CO2, carbon had no lone pairs. Carbon had 4 electrons in its valence shell, 2 got shared over here, so there's nothing left in the outer shell, so there is no repulsion, or there's no lone pair repulsion. So the basic idea is that all the valence shell bonded electrons and the lone pairs, they would be repelling each other, and they would try to be as far away from each other as possible. So they would try to keep as far away from each other as possible, and that is going to determine the shape of or the arrangement of the molecule. So this is something that you need to keep in mind, and that is that all these bonds and lone pairs are going to have the greatest repulsion, because lone pairs, remember, bonded electrons and lone pair electrons are slightly different, because bonded electrons, they get stretched by another atom. Another atom is pulling those electrons, so they're further away from the central atom. So if they're further away, the repulsion is going to be lesser. Lone pairs, no one is attracting lone pairs, so those electrons are very tightly held together. They have a greater charge density, they're more concentrated, so they create a greater repulsion. So remember this, lone pairs, they're going to have the greatest amount of repulsion, and then triple bond, because they have more electrons, double bond, then single bonds will have the least amount of repulsion. So this thing has to be carefully noted, that lone pairs are going to create a greater amount of repulsion. Lone pairs are going to push these bonded pairs of electrons much strongly compared to the bonded pairs of electrons pushing each other. So they're going to create more repulsion. So over here I've briefly summarized all the shapes of the molecule. So if you have two bond pairs or two bonds, then they're going to repel each other very, very strongly, and the shape is going to be linear. Similarly, if you have three bonds are going to repel each other, and the shape is going to be fan-shaped, and it would be called trigonal planar. So write down the word planar as well. Similarly, if you have, and the angles are going to be 120 degrees. Similarly, if you have, now there would be different derivatives of this shape. One arrangement would be that instead of having three atoms bonded to a single atom in the middle, what you could have is you could have a lone pair on one side. So if there's a lone pair on one side, then there are two bonds. The shape is pretty much the same, except for the fact that the lone pairs on this side, there's no atom attached over there. So the arrangement is still the same, but since there's nothing attached over here, this shape is going to be bent. It's going to be bent. So when you have one lone pair and two bond pairs, the shape is going to be bent. There's nothing on this side. There's no atom attached on this side. So the angle would also decrease from 120 degrees. It would be slightly lesser to 117 degrees because the lone pairs are going to exert a greater amount of repulsion. So these bonds over here, they would be slightly closer to each other. Similarly, you have the third type. If you have four bonds are going to repel each other in three-dimensional space. The arrangement would be tetrahedral, and all the angles are going to be 109.5 degrees. So all the bonds would be as far away from each other as possible. One bond is coming towards you, one is going into the page, one on the left, one on the top. So all the bonds, they're going to repel each other. And then there would be derivatives of this tetrahedral arrangement. So if you have four bonds, the shape is going to be tetrahedral. But if you could have other derivatives, for example, this one over here, the shape is still tetrahedral. You might have a lone pair instead of a bond. So if you have a lone pair instead of a bond, the shape is pretty much the same, except on the top, there's a lone pair now. So there's nothing attached over here. There are a bunch of electrons over there, but nothing attached on that side. So that wouldn't be counted as the shape. So it's going to look like a pyramid. instead of the tetrahedral structure, it's going to look like a pyramid. It's going to be called trigonal pyramidal. And when does this happen? When you have one lone pair and three bond pairs. Similarly, there could be another arrangement similar to this tetrahedral, derived from this tetrahedral structure, and that is that you might have two lone pairs. So the arrangement is still the same, the tetrahedral arrangement. All the electrons are arranged tetrahedrally, but since there's nothing attached on these two sides, they would be counted in shape. So it's going to be a bent shape. On two sides, they're going to be lone pairs. And since the lone pairs exert a greater amount of repulsion, the angles are going to be closer together. These two bonds are going to be closer together, and the angle would decrease to 104.5 degrees. So you can have two lone pairs and two bond pairs. Similarly, you could have a trigonal bipyramidal arrangement if you have five pairs of bonds. So a fan in the middle, one bond on the top and one on the right on the bottom, they're all repelling each other. The angles on the top bonds and the fan over here, there would be 90 degrees. Angles between the fan-shaped arrangement, that's going to be 120 degrees. And this arrangement could have many derivative shapes. The basic idea arrangement is the same, except that instead of having bonds or bonded electrons, you could have lone pairs. So if you have one lone pair, the shape would be seesaw. It's going to look like a seesaw. So it's one lone pair, four bond pairs. You could have, in the same shape, you could have two lone pairs. So this should be D-shaped because there's nothing attached on the side. There are electrons there, but nothing attached over there. So two lone pairs, three bond pairs is going to give you this arrangement. And then you're going to have a linear shape as well if you have three lone pairs. So on all three sides, there are lone pairs, nothing attached on those sides, no atom attached on the sides. So there's only one bond on the top and one at the bottom. So the shape would be three lone pairs, two bond pairs. It's going to be a linear shape. And then lastly, you can have six bonded pairs of electrons, six bonds. So that's going to be octahedral, one bond on the top, one on the bottom, one on the right, one on the left, one coming out of the page, one going into the page. Now this last one is also going to have some derivative shapes. So for example, instead of having six bonded pairs of electrons, you could have one lone pair on one side. So if it has one lone pair on that side, there's nothing attached on that side. So the shape is going to be square pyramidal instead of an octahedral shape if there was something attached on this side. Or you could have a square planar shape if you have two lone pairs. So two lone pairs, nothing attached on the top, nothing attached on the bottom. So they're just four pairs of bonds, and they would be arranged in a square manner, square planar arrangement. So two lone pairs, four bond pairs. That's going to be your shape. So this pretty much, these five are the basic shapes, and you need to remember all the angles. Linear shape is going to have a 180 degree angle, 120 degrees, 109.5. And as you can see, as the number of bonds increase, the bonds become closer together, so the angles decrease. And you need to know what the derivative shapes are going to be. If you have, instead of having four bonds, you have one lone pair, the shape would be trigonal pyramidal and bent and so on. So let's try and do a few examples quickly to figure out what the shape or whether you can predict the shape of a molecule or not. So let's say this is my molecule over here, and I need to figure out what the shape of, remember this is a structural formula. Structural formula is not a three-dimensional formula. It doesn't tell you the shape of the molecule. It just tells you which atom is connected to which atom. So it doesn't tell you about the angles. So this is what the structural formula is. The first thing I would try to do if I'm given a question like this is, I'm going to start off with the first one. And we need to identify lone pairs. And I'll tell you how to identify lone pairs. For example, this first carbon, if you look at this first carbon, it's in group 4. Which means that it has four valence electrons. So it's bonded to four atoms, which means that all the four valence electrons are involved in bonding. So there are no lone pairs, there are no leftover electrons. You need to figure out whether they're going to be leftover electrons or not. So four electrons, one shared here, one shared here, one shared here, and one has been shared over here. So nothing is left. So you just have four pairs, four bonds, or four bonded pairs of electrons. So let's go back and see what the shape is going to be. Now in the diagram, four bonded bonds are going to have this tetrahedral arrangement, which means that the arrangement around carbon in the molecule that we were discussing is going to be tetrahedral. So this over here you can see is the tetrahedral arrangement that I've drawn for this particular carbon atom. Now this carbon atom is bonded to another carbon atom on the right. So let's draw that carbon atom. Focus on this carbon atom. As you can see, this carbon atom has three bonded pairs of electrons. One bond over here, one bond over here, and a double bond over here. Remember to treat a double bond as one entity because all these electrons are together. So it's basically three bonded pairs of electrons. And if you go back and have a look, three bonded pairs of electrons are going to have a trigonal planar arrangement. It's going to be a fan-shaped arrangement. All the angles are going to be 120 degrees. So this is what we are looking for. So I'm going to draw a 120 degree fan-shaped arrangement. There's going to be an H. So all these angles over here, they're going to be 120 degrees over here, and it's going to be a fan-shaped arrangement. So there's going to be a double bond over here, one bond over here, one bond over here. So it's going to look like a fan-shaped planar arrangement, trigonal planar, and all the angles are going to be 120 degrees. Then you focus on this carbon atom, and again, if around this carbon atom, the arrangement, one bond pair, and one bond pair. Double bond, think of it as one thing. So this arrangement is also going to be three bonded pairs of electrons. So this arrangement is also going to be fan-shaped. So let's draw a fan-shaped arrangement. So there's 1H, 120 degree angle. At the bottom, there's an oxygen atom. So, and then focus on this oxygen atom. Now, over here, oxygen is in group 6. Now, over here, you have to be careful. Oxygen has two bonds around it. But remember, it's in group 6, which means that it has a total of 6 electrons in its valence shell. So one shade here, you're left with 4 electrons. So there would be 4 electrons or 2 lone pairs around it. So the arrangement around oxygen would be determined by 2 lone pairs and 2 bonded pairs of electrons. So let's go back and have a look and see what the arrangement is. So in total, you had 4 electron densities around oxygen. But it's going to be a derivative of this tetrahedral arrangement. It's going to be 2 lone pairs. On two sides, there's going to be 2 lone pairs, and on two sides, they're going to be bonds. So the angle would be 104.5. The bonds are going to be closer together because of the repulsion from these lone pairs. So this is going to be the arrangement around this oxygen. So as you can see, this OH around the oxygen, it's going to be bent, and the angle is going to be 104.5. So very quickly, I'm going to write down all the angles. This one is 109.5 degrees. Over here, the angles were 120 degrees around this carbon atom as well. And over here, the angle was 104.5 degrees. This was trigonal planar. This was also trigonal planar fan shape. This was tetrahedral, and this one was bent.
Another example question, and you'll be asked a lot of past paper questions where they'll be asking you about the shape of the molecule. So remember, by just looking at the number of bond pairs, for example, they're asking what are the approximate bond angles of X, Y, and Z in the molecule of this particular molecule which is drawn. So you just count the lone pairs. Remember, lone pairs are always hidden. You have to always look for lone pairs. So carbon has 4 electrons, one shade over here, one shade over here, 2 got shade over here. So there are no electrons left, so it won't have any lone pairs. So carbon has one bond over here, one bond pair electrons over here, and a bond pair electrons over here. So 3. So this shape would be trigonal planar. It's going to be 120 degrees. So this fan-shaped arrangement has been drawn over here, 120 degrees angle. So these two over here, they would probably be correct. X is 120 degrees. Then you have another carbon over here. It's exactly the same arrangement, one bond, and a double bond over here. So the arrangement is going to be, it's going to be the same arrangement, fan-shaped. And there's a CH2 on the other side. So that arrangement would also be exactly the same. And then the rest of the molecule continues. So this would also be 120 degrees. So that would give you option C as the correct option. This last one over here, you can see carbon making 4 bonds. So 4 bonds, 4 single bonds. That is going to be a tetrahedral arrangement. So this carbon over here is, all the bonds are going to be arranged in a tetrahedral manner. When you have 4 bonds, there are no lone pairs. In a tetrahedral arrangement, the angle is 109 degrees. So option C is going to be the correct option. So remember, count the lone pairs, count the number of bond pairs, and always think of double bonds and these double bonds as one entity.
or one pair of electrons. For example, if they had asked you for the shape of this sulfur atom, around the sulfur atom, you would notice that sulfur has, you need to count the number of lone pairs, group 6, it's in group 6. Group 6 means it has 6 valence electrons, one shade over here, one shade over here, two got shared over there, so there would be one lone pair, two electrons would be left, four would have been shared. So sulfur's arrangement, if you have one lone pair and you have three bond pairs, one over here, one over here, one double bond, one single bond, so around it, it's a double bond, single bond, single bond. So it's going to be a pyramidal shape with the lone pair sitting on top and the angles are going to be 107 degrees. The next type of bonding that we are going to discuss, we dealt with shapes. There's a thing called dative covalent bonds, which are also known as quartet bonds. Now in dative bonds, what happens is that it's like a normal covalent bond except for one difference. That difference is that in a dative bond, both electrons are shared by the same atom. They're coming from the same atom. So usually in a covalent bond, for example, if there's an H2 molecule, usually what happens is one atom contributes one electron, the other atom contributes another electron. So this is a normal covalent bond, but in a dative bond, both electrons are contributed by the same atom. So I'm going to show you how a dative covalent bond would be formed. Now, normally a dative bond, when a dative bond is being formed, it's going to be formed between a molecule or an atom that has lone pairs, those extra electrons in its outer valence shell that are not doing anything initially, that are not involved in bonding, they're completely full. So they're full orbitals. If a molecule or an atom has full orbitals in its valence shell, then it's capable of forming a dative bond with another atom or molecule that is electron deficient, that needs electrons, or in other words, has empty orbitals in its valence shell. So these two compounds are going to form a dative bond with each other. So let's see how that's possible. For example, this here is my water molecule. And oxygen is in group 6. Group 6 means that it's sharing one electron over here, one over here. There are four electrons remaining. There are four electrons in its outer shell, which means that they are two lone pairs. I can write down the electronic configuration of oxygen as well. This here is the outer electronic configuration. The 2PY and 2PZ, they are forming two bonds with hydrogen. So two hydrogens, they ended up forming bonds with these two orbitals. And oxygen in its outer shell has two orbitals that are completely full. These are your lone pairs. These over here are your lone pairs that you can see over here. So there are four electrons that are not doing anything right now, that are not involved in bonding. Two of the orbitals ended up bonding with the hydrogen atoms because they needed one electron each. These two did not bond initially because they don't need any electrons. They're completely full. Now, let's say on the other side, you have an H plus 1 ion. Now, H had one electron, but even that one electron is gone. So it has an orbital that is completely empty. So there's nothing there. It needs electrons. It has a positive ion. It's going to be attracted to electrons. So when it sees this water molecule, when it sees these electrons that are not doing anything, this H positive is going to be attracted to these electrons. So these electrons are going to get attracted to this H positive ion. And what would eventually happen is that this H plus 1 is going to get attracted to these electrons over here. And one topic that is frequently discussed related to dative bonds is AlCl3 dimerization. So AlCl3 can datively bond with another AlCl3 molecule. What happens is that the two molecules are capable of joining together to form this dimer, which is Al2Cl6. This over here is Al's outer electronic configuration. It's 3s2, 3px1, three electrons in its outer shell. But remember, there are four orbitals. So when aluminium bonds, it tries to maximize electron bond formation. So there would be one electron left in the 3s. One electron would move to the 3py. So three orbitals with electrons, they would be involved in bonding. So that is how AlCl3 is going to be produced. This is how a molecule of AlCl3, Al, and its three orbitals would bond with three Cl's. One getting attracted over here, the other getting attracted over here, the third orbital bonding with the other Cl. So three orbitals, but AL has one empty orbital. That means AL, even after forming three bonds, it's going to be electron deficient. It needs two electrons. So what happens in dimerization is that this empty orbital over here, it needs electrons. It would form a dative bond. Meanwhile, on the other hand, Cl has, it's in group 7, which means it has a total of 3 lone pairs. So it has all these lone pairs, which are not being used. So if you have two molecules of AlCl3, here I've drawn this other molecule. Remember, Al is electron deficient, needs two electrons. So what it can do is it can form a dative bond with the neighboring Cl from the other molecule, and this dative bond could be formed. Aluminium had an empty orbital. Cl had these extra electrons in its outer shell, which were not involved in bonding. So those electrons can get attracted to the electron deficient aluminium, and the two could be bonded together. And the same would happen with this Al over here. This Al, it can datively bond with this Cl. The Cl can provide it with lone pairs, and Al can accept them. So the two AlCl3 molecules can dimerize, and they can form this Al2Cl6 molecule over here. So that's how dimerization of AlCl3. Dimer means that two monomers have joined together. So that would result in the formation of this dimer over here. So this is a neater version of the same thing. This is the dot and cross diagram. As you can notice over here, Cl is giving the lone pairs to Al over here. This Cl is giving lone pairs to Al over here. So that's how a dimer is going to be formed. Two AlCl3 molecules joined together to form this Al2Cl6 molecule. Let's quickly do a few more examples of dative bonding. So I have a molecule of NH3 over here. N has lone pairs in NH3. The way to figure out it has lone pairs is N is in group 5, which means it has 5 valence electrons. So what basically means is that 3 of the electrons are bonding, and there would be 2 electrons that would be left over that would be completely unused, that would not be involved in bonding. So I've written the outer electronic configuration of nitrogen, and you can see that it has 7 electrons, 5 in the valence shells, 3 orbitals are half-filled, which means that they need electrons. So they get those electrons from hydrogen. So these 3 orbitals, they bond with hydrogen. They get the electrons from hydrogen. And you have this completely full outer orbital, which is your lone pair. So there's a lone pair over here. There's a completely full outer orbital that needs no electrons that is available for bonding, for forming a dative bond. So if you have an H-positive ion, again, H-positive ion is an electron-deficient substance with 0 electrons. It has a completely empty orbital. This H-positive ion will be attracted to this completely full outer orbital, this lone pair. It's going to get attracted, and it would stick to it. So it's going to go over there, and this H-positive ion will bond or will get attracted to these electrons over here, forming a dative bond like this, as I've shown over here. So if you look over here, once this dative bond is formed, this H positive ion goes and gets attracted to those lone pairs. Remember, the positive charge would no longer be on this ion over here, because this H, which was electron deficient, would get its electrons. It would start sharing electrons from N. So the positive charge on H would no longer be present, but this positive charge would now be on the entire molecule. So whenever a positive ion gets attached to a neutral molecule, the entire ion is going to get a positive charge, because overall the positive charge is no longer going to be localized over here. This H positive has gotten its electron, but if you count the total number of protons and electrons in this molecule, you will notice that there is one electron less, which means because you had an electron deficient ion that was coming in, that electron deficient ion is going to create an electron deficiency in this molecule. But the positive charge is no longer going to be localized, but it would be on the entire molecule, entire ion. So this is your NH4 plus 1 ion. Let's now do another dative bonding or coordinate bonding example. Here I'm trying to datively bond a BEF2 molecule with an NH3 molecule. Now BE over here is electron deficient, whereas N, we just studied N. N has these lone pairs. It has a completely full outer orbital, so it has electrons available that are not involved in bonding at the moment. But let's focus on BE first, because I told you BE is electron deficient, so I'm now going to write how, or tell you how it's electron deficient. So this over here is beryllium's electronic configuration. It has four electrons, so it's 1s2, 2s2, 2px, 2py, and 2pz are all empty, they're zero. So ignore the inner orbital, let's just focus on the outer orbital. Remember, when an atom is bonding, what it's going to do is it has two electrons in its outer shell. So it's going to distribute these two electrons. So there would be only one electron in the 2s, and there would only be one electron. One electron would shift into the empty 2s 2px orbital. But even after distributing electrons, it would have two completely empty orbitals. As you can see over here, one of the orbitals over here is going to bond, or it's going to try and pull electrons from fluorine. The other orbital is also going to try and fill itself up. It's going to try and pull electrons from fluorine. So beryllium is going to be forming two bonds, but there would be two completely empty orbitals available. So there would be two spaces around beryllium which would be completely empty. So how would the data bond occur? The data bond would happen that beryllium needs electrons in this orbital over here and also in this orbital over here. So N has these lone pairs. These lone pairs can be attracted to beryllium, and beryllium can gain these electrons. So the data bond formation would be something like this. That a molecule of BeF2 is present. Be is electron deficient. N brings its lone pairs. Beryllium needs those electrons. So a data bond is going to be formed over here. So that would fill one of beryllium's orbital, empty orbital in its outer shell. But beryllium still has another empty orbital. So it could attract another NH3 molecule. And that other NH3 molecule is again going to attract lone pairs from NH3. And beryllium can form another dative bond over here. So it can form two dative bonds with NH3. The lone pairs on N can be attracted to one of the empty orbitals, and another lone pair can be attracted to one of the other empty orbitals in beryllium. Now we're going to discuss polarity and electronegativity in this particular topic. So the first question is that what is electronegativity? It is the tendency for an atom to gain electrons. Different atoms, some atoms like to gain electrons, some atoms like to lose electrons. They don't have a tendency to gain electrons. For example, we know that fluorine is always forming a -1 ion, which means it has a very high tendency to gain electrons, whereas sodium never forms a negative ion. It never gains an electron, which means that it's not electronegative. In other words, it's electropositive. So some atoms are highly electronegative, they'd like to gain electrons. Some atoms, they don't like to gain electrons, they instead like to lose electrons, so they have low electronegativity. So how do you figure out which substances are electronegative and which substances are not electronegative? For this, you have an electronegativity table, or you need to understand a table. I'm going to draw a periodic table first. Now this over here is my periodic table. As you can see, these are group 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8. The group 8 is not given because it generally never gains electrons. It has complete outer shells. So group 8 is missing over here. Now in this table, this is known as the Pauling scale. The Pauling scale is a scale on which the tendency for an atom to gain electrons is highlighted. So over here, this very bright red indicates that it has a very high tendency to gain electrons. The yellow ones indicate that they have a very low tendency to gain electrons. They're not going to gain electrons, they're instead going to lose electrons. So now you don't need to remember this diagram. What you need to know is the trend. So the first trend that needs to be known is that as you move across the period in a periodic table, as you move towards the right, the electronegativity increases. Now you already pretty much know this, that the elements on the right are the ones that are gaining electrons. So as you move to the right of the periodic table, you get non-metals, they have a higher tendency to gain electrons. On the left side, you have metals which don't have a tendency to gain electrons. Instead, they are the ones that are always losing electrons. So why? The question now is, why is it that as you move to the right, the electronegativity of atoms is going to increase? Well, the simple answer is that you have more protons. As you move to the right, for example, lithium over here has three protons. Beryllium has four protons. Boron has 5 protons, 6, 7, 8, 9. So as you're moving to the right of the periodic table across the period, the number of protons increase. If the number of protons increase, there's going to be more attraction for electrons. You have the same number of shells. The atom size is almost the same, except that the fluorine is going to have 9 protons, whereas lithium is going to just have 3 protons. 9 protons are going to have a much stronger attraction for electrons, so it would have a much greater tendency
to attract electrons. So electronegativity increases to the right. Why? If the simple reason is that you have more protons on the right side. The other trend that must be known is that as you move up the periodic table, up a group, electronegativity increases. Fluorine is more electronegative, whereas iodine is less electronegative. Fluorine has a greater tendency to attract electrons, and this pretty much applies to all groups. Oxygen is more electronegative compared to sulfur, and as you move down the group, the electronegativity keeps on decreasing. The same is true for group 1 as well. So any group, as you move down the group, electronegativity decreases. As you move up the group, electronegativity is going to increase. And again, the question is, why is that? So the simple answer is that as you move up the group, these atoms are smaller. As you move down the group, these atoms are bigger in size. So smaller atoms are less shielded, which means that the nucleus is more exposed. There are not a lot of electrons around them. So the nucleus is more exposed and it will have a greater attraction for electrons. Bigger atoms, for example, iodine has a lot of electrons, almost 53 electrons approximately. So its nucleus is going to have so many electrons around it that it would be very hard for the nucleus to attract more electrons because it's already surrounded by a lot of electrons. So smaller atoms are less shielded, the nucleus is more exposed, so the attraction for electrons is greater. So up the group, smaller atoms, they're more electronegative. So that's the basic trend. So the basic idea is the elements that are right in this corner are the most electronegative ones, and the elements that are right at the opposite end of this periodic table, they are the least electronegative. Towards the right, electronegativity increases, to upwards, electronegativity increases. So you need to know which elements are more electronegative, which elements are less electronegative. For example, if you're comparing fluorine with carbon, fluorine is the one that's more electronegative. If you're comparing fluorine with iodine, you must know that fluorine is more electronegative because it's up the group. If you're comparing carbon with lithium, you should know that carbon is to the right, so it's going to be more electronegative. So you must know in comparison which element is more electronegative, which element has a greater tendency to attract electrons, and which element has a lesser tendency to attract electrons. Now this electronegativity is going to decide whether a molecule is going to be polar, whether the electrons are going to be distributed evenly between two atoms, or whether one atom is going to attract electrons strongly and it would have more electron density compared to the other atom, and it would make the molecule polar. So I'm going to now describe what this term polar and non-polar actually means. First type of molecule that I'm going to study is or discuss is the non-polar covalent molecule. Now non-polar covalent molecules are the ones where there is perfect sharing going on. The reason why perfect sharing is going on is that either you have no difference in electronegativity of atoms or dipoles cancel out. What that basically means is, let's have a look at a fluorine molecule. In a fluorine molecule, one fluorine is sharing electrons with another fluorine. Both fluorines are trying to attract these electrons. This fluorine would try to pull these electrons towards itself. This fluorine will also try and pull electrons towards itself. And as you can also see in this periodic table, you would notice that fluorine is right in the corner. It's probably one of the most electronegative elements. So fluorine attracts electrons very, very strongly. So these are your electrons over here. This fluorine is trying to pull electrons towards the right. This fluorine is trying to gain those electrons and is pulling towards the left. So the two forces of attraction over here, they're going to get cancelled out because they are equal forces of attraction. Both of them are fluorine atoms. Fluorine is going to pull these electrons with a certain amount of force. The other fluorine would also pull these electrons with an equal amount of force. Both fluorines have exactly the same electronegativity. So if both fluorines are pulling these electrons, where would the electrons go? The electrons are going to stay right in the middle. They're not going to go to either side. So the electron's going to stay in the middle, and the electron cloud over here in the middle, it's going to be perfectly distributed between the two fluorine atoms. It's not going to be shifted to one side or the other side. So this is what is meant by the term dipoles cancel out. So this molecule would have all the electrons would be evenly distributed. So all shared electrons are evenly distributed. Now this concept that dipoles cancel out, and let me explain to you what this term dipole also means, is a dipole is created when there is polarity. And polarity is created when the electrons get shifted to one side or the other side. So for example, these electrons over here, if they were strongly attracted to one of the atoms, these electrons would be closer to that atom. And if they were closer to that atom, this side of the molecule would have a partial negative charge because of the electrons being closer to it, and the other side of the molecule will have a partial positive charge if these electrons are closer to one side. Similarly, if these electrons were closer to the other side, the other atom had strongly attracted those electrons, then that side would have a partial negative charge and the other side would have a partial positive charge. So the creation of these poles, a positive side and a negative side, that is what is referred to as dipoles. But in this molecule, there would not be any dipoles. The electrons would remain evenly distributed. Now, this concept that dipoles cancel out depends a lot on the shape of the molecules as well. So, for example, let's do another molecule. So, here's an AlCl3 molecule, and I'm going to discuss whether they're going to be dipoles or not. So, there's shared pairs of electrons over here between Al and Cl. Al and Cl are sharing electrons, and you have Al and Cl sharing electrons over here as well. Now, if you look at the electronegativity table, you notice that Cl is right near this corner, so it's very electronegative, whereas Al is over here. Al almost has half the electronegativity. Al has no tendency to, or doesn't have a strong tendency to attract electrons. So Cl is highly electronegative. So Cl is going to pull those electrons very, very strongly. So over here, these arrows represent that the Cl atom is pulling these electrons very strongly. Cl is going to try and attract these electrons very, very strongly. It's going to try and keep them closer to it. This Cl is also going to try and pull the shared pair of electrons closer to it. This Cl would also do the same. Now, if you remember a little bit of vectors in physics, you would notice that the electrons are not going to move anywhere because the dipoles or the forces of attraction, they're going to get cancelled out because they're all pointing in the opposite direction. One Cl is pulling electrons in this direction, the other Cl is pulling electrons in this direction, and the third Cl is pulling electrons in this direction. So the force of attraction, exactly in the same way as we were talking about the fluorine molecule over here, one fluorine pulling electrons in this direction, the other fluorine pulling electrons in this direction, the force of attraction on these electrons is going to get cancelled out. The same would pretty much be true for AlCl3, that the dipoles are going to get cancelled out, and this would be a nonpolar molecule. It would have no regions of partial positive or partial negative. The electrons would remain evenly distributed in this molecule. Now, there are examples where the dipoles don't cancel out. Now, for example, you have an SO2 molecule over here that I've drawn. Now, the shape of the SO2 molecule is bent because there's a lone pair, and the lone pair is going to repel the other two bonds. So the two oxygens would be pointing to downwards. The angles would be approximately 120 degrees. It's going to be fan-shaped because you have this lone pair of electrons over here, and a pair of electrons over here. So there would be three pairs of electrons, and they would be 120 degrees apart from each other. It's going to be a fan-shaped arrangement, except that you wouldn't call it fan-shaped or trigonal planar because there's nothing attached on this side over here. So it's going to be a bent shape. These two things are attached over here. This is going to be a bent molecule. And the angles would be slightly less than, probably 170 degrees, slightly less than 120 degrees because the lone pair is going to exert a greater repulsion. Now, focus on this molecule. You have sulfur and you have oxygen. The first thing is, which one is more electronegative, oxygen or sulfur? So if you have a look at this periodic table, you would notice that oxygen is right in the corner. S is somewhere below it. So sulfur's electronegativity is lesser compared to oxygen's. So oxygen over here is going to pull these electrons downwards very, very strongly. Now, in this case, again, bring your concept, revise your concept of vectors in physics. You would notice that both oxygen atoms are pulling these electrons downwards. They're trying to pull these electrons because oxygen is very electronegative. Now, what's going to happen is that in this case, dipole is not going to get cancelled out. Both the oxygen atoms are pulling electrons downwards. So there would be more negative charge below on the bottom side of the molecule because both oxygens are pulling these electrons closer to them. The forces of attraction are not cancelling out because they're not pointing in opposite directions. Both the forces of attraction are pointing downwards. So the bottom side of the molecule is going to get a partial negative charge because the electrons would be closer to this oxygen. The electrons would also be closer to this oxygen. So they're going to get a partial negative charge, whereas the top side of the molecule is going to get a partial positive charge because the electron distribution is now going to be skewed. Previously, in these molecules, the electrons were evenly distributed everywhere because the forces of attraction or the electronegativity were getting cancelled out. But in this case, the electronegativity is not getting cancelled out. Both oxygens pulling electrons downwards, both oxygens, more electron cloud over here towards this oxygen. So this molecule is going to be a polar molecule. And it's going to have an overall dipole. there would be a region of positive charge, and there would be a region of slight negative charge and another slight negative charge. So these are your dipoles that have been created because now there is a difference in electronegativity and the dipoles are not getting cancelled out.
Let's quickly have a look at another molecule where again dipoles would cancel out. Over here you have a molecule of CCl4 where carbon is bonded to 4Cl, so 1Cl, 2Cl, 3Cl and 4Cl, and it's a tetrahedral arrangement, so there's a pyramidal shaped Cl bonds at the bottom and 1Cl at the top. Now again, if you look at the electronegativity table, then you would notice Cl over here, and you would see that Cl is right at the corner, so it's extremely electronegative. Carbon towards the left slightly, so not that electronegative. Now Cl being more electronegative is going to pull these electrons towards it, but again according to the shape of the molecule you would notice that the attractive forces are going to get cancelled out. So all these attractive forces, they're going to get cancelled out because all the Cl's are pointing in opposite directions. They're all pulling electrons in completely opposite directions. So like a vector diagram, their forces of attraction are going to get cancelled out. And this molecule would not be polar. It's going to be a non-polar molecule. But let's take another example of an 8Cl3 molecule or CHCl3 molecule. Over here, you don't have 4Cl's, instead you have one hydrogen bonded at one end. Now over here, as you can see, Cl, as we have talked about, Cl is very electronegative. So Cl would be pulling electrons towards itself. So this tiny pyramid at the bottom, the tetrahedral arrangement, the Cl's are pulling the electrons downwards. But there is no electronegative. H is not an electronegative element. H has very low electronegativity compared to Cl. So it's not going to be pulling electrons upwards. So the net result would be that the bottom side would have a greater negative charge density. There would be more electrons at the bottom side, and there would be lesser electrons on the top of the molecule. H would have a slight or partial positive charge. Reason being, all the electrons would be pulled downwards by Cl. So over here, dipoles are not cancelling out, and this molecule is going to be a polar molecule. So let's also define what the opposite of non-polar covalent molecules are. They are polar covalent molecules, like the one that I've shown over here. These molecules are polar, and the electrons in these molecules are unequally shared. One of the atom might be attracting electrons more strongly, so they would be spending more time with one of the atom, which would result in the development of a partial negative charge. The same that we saw over here in this SO2 molecule as well. The oxygens were more electronegative, so electrons were spending more time at the bottom, so the bottom side of the molecule was had a partial negative charge. So the definition of a polar covalent molecule is that when electrons in a bond are unequally shared, which results in the development of partial positive and partial negative charges. Now there would be two reasons why a molecule would be polar. So the first thing would be that there's going to be a difference in electronegativity. So the atoms would have different electronegativities, as is the case over here where Cl is more electronegative. So Cl is pulling electrons towards, all the Cl atoms are pulling electrons strongly towards themselves. And the second condition is that the dipoles, they shouldn't cancel out. They don't cancel out. So the shape of the molecule would be such that the atoms would be attracting electrons, but not from opposite sides. For example, over here, the dipoles are cancelling out, although Cl is more electronegative, but over here the dipoles are not cancelling out because both atoms are pulling electrons downwards. So the shape of the molecule is also important in determining whether a molecule is going to be polar or it's not going to be polar. Important point is that you must know that carbon and hydrogen atoms, they have very similar electronegativities. So you can have a look at this table over here. You would see carbon over here having a Pauling scale value of 2.5, whereas hydrogen is 2.1. So the electronegativities are very similar. Not exactly the same, but very similar. So the reason why we mention carbon and hydrogen is that a lot of organic molecules, which makes up most of the chemistry related to living organisms, they contain carbon and hydrogen. So you must know that any carbon chain, any alkyl chain, it's going to be almost non-polar because the electronegativities are very similar. So there would be no partial positive, partial negative charges, or not very significant dipoles would be produced. So it's going to be almost non-polar in any organic molecule. So as another example, think of this aldehyde butanol molecule. You would notice that there's a carbon chain. So there's a carbon chain going on over here. This side is going to be nonpolar. Because carbon and hydrogen have very similar electronegativity, so the dipoles are going to get cancelled out. Whereas this side, this part of the molecule, oxygen is very electronegative, so this side of the molecule would have a polarity. The carbon over here would have dipoles. It's going to be partial positive and partial negative. So remember about very large molecules. Very large molecules are going to have regions where there would be polarity, and there would be regions where there would be no polarity. Especially organic molecules. Think of organic molecules as very large molecules. Some part of the molecule would be nonpolar. Carbon and hydrogen have very similar electronegativities, whereas oxygen at this end is extremely electronegative, which means that electrons would be closer to oxygen, and it's going to have a partial negative charge, whereas carbon is going to have a partial positive charge, and this side would be polar. We do one example question on polarity. The question is, which molecule has the largest overall dipole? So you have to figure this out. And from our knowledge, remember all these molecules are drawn correctly. Their shapes are correctly drawn. Carbon, whenever it makes a double bond, it's going to be trigonal planar. It's going to be a fan-shaped molecule. So this carbon over here, one pair of electrons, pairs of electrons over here, and over here. So it's going to be arranged in a fan-shaped manner. So all these atoms are drawn correctly in the correct shape. Let's focus on the first one. The first one is going to be nonpolar. And the reason it's going to be nonpolar is because, as we just mentioned, carbon and hydrogen have almost similar electronegativity. So their dipoles are going to get cancelled out. So it's going to be almost nonpolar. Let's focus on the next molecule, option B. You would notice that this molecule over here has an oxygen atom over here, which means oxygen is on the right corner of the periodic table. It's very, very electronegative. So that would result, it's going to drag all the electrons towards the left, towards itself. So oxygen is extremely electronegative. It's more electronegative compared to all the other atoms. So it's going to pull all the electrons towards itself partially. So this side of the molecule will be partial negative, whereas the rest of the molecule would have a slight electron deficiency. It's going to be partial positive. Let's look at option C now. In option C, you have a carbon, and it's again fan-shaped. And it's bonded on one side by oxygen, which we already know is very electronegative. But on the other side, it's bonded with Cl, which is also very electronegative. So if I open the Pauling scale, you will notice that oxygen and chlorine, they're almost diagonal to each other. So their electronegativities are very similar. This is 3.5, whereas oxygen is 3.5, whereas chlorine is 3. So they're almost, remember, elements that are diagonal, they have almost similar electronegativities. Which means in option C, the dipole would be there, but the dipoles are going to be very, very small. It's going to be partial. Oxygen is going to be partial negative. Chlorine would slightly be partial positive, but the dipoles are going to be very slight, as there's going to be very less difference in electronegativity. So they would almost cancel out. So almost no dipoles over here. And let's move to option D. In option D, carbon and hydrogen part, that's nonpolar. We already discussed all those bonds are going to be nonpolar. But look at the two Cl. Cl's are electronegative, so Cl's are pulling electrons. But both Cl's are pointing in opposite direction. This one is pulling electrons to the top. This one is pulling electrons downwards. So both Cl's have almost the same electronegativity. So their dipoles are going to get cancelled out. So overall, this molecule is going to be nonpolar as well. So the greatest polarity would be shown, the largest overall dipole would be shown by the first, by the second option, which is option B. So now move to the next topic, which is related to dipoles and polar and nonpolar molecules, and that is intermolecular forces. These are attractive forces that exist between molecules, and they are usually weaker. They're very weak. Most of the time, they are very, very weak. Molecules don't really attract each other very strongly. That needs to be clarified initially is that intermolecular forces are always between simple molecules. So, for example, you have a CO2 molecule over here. All these CO2 molecules would be attracting each other by some attractive force. So, this CO2 molecule and this CO2 molecule, they would have some sort of intermolecular force which is going to be weak, which is why these molecules are randomly moving around. CO2 is usually in gaseous state. They can lose energy and solidify, but usually it's in gaseous state, which means that these intermolecular forces are not they're not very, very strong. The bonds between the atoms are very strong. For example, oxygen and carbon and oxygen are very strongly bonded to each other. So the bonds within the atom are very, very strong, but one molecule would not really be attracting the other molecule that strongly. In some cases, it would be attracting strongly, but remember, in most covalent, simple covalent molecules, one molecule doesn't really attract the other molecule very strongly. So these would be intermolecular forces. These dotted lines are intermolecular forces. Is another example of simple covalent molecules. Water is a simple covalent molecule. It only has one oxygen bonded to two hydrogens, covalently bonded. So there's one water molecule and there's another water molecule, and they would be attracting each other by weak intermolecular forces. So these dotted lines are those intermolecular forces. So all these water molecules, they would be sticking together. Water is usually liquid, but it evaporates very easily, which means that the molecules could easily, in practice, overcome these intermolecular forces and they can escape. So water molecules have very weak intermolecular forces as well. The first question is, what are the properties that depend on intermolecular forces? If particles are attracting each other, so what type of physical properties would be dependent on intermolecular forces? So the very first property that depends on intermolecular forces are the states and the melting and boiling points. So if the particles are very strongly attracting each other, they would be tightly held together in a solid lattice, and they would have high melting and boiling points. The particles would not be able to move very easily. If they have weaker intermolecular forces, they might slide past each other, so they might be in liquid state. Or if the intermolecular forces are very weak and particles are relatively energetic, they would be in gaseous state and they would be freely moving around in all directions. Here's the first property, melting and boiling points, that are going to depend on intermolecular forces. So stronger intermolecular forces would lead to higher melting and boiling points, and vice versa, weaker intermolecular forces would lead to lesser melting and boiling points. It would be easier for the substance to melt or boil. Second property that depends on intermolecular forces is the solubility of substances. Now, the rule for solubility is that like dissolves like, or similar types of substances dissolve other similar type of substances. What that basically means is that if you have a polar molecule, then it's more likely to dissolve other polar molecules into it. If you have a non-polar molecule, non-polar molecules would dissolve other non-polar substances. So polar dissolves polar, non-polar is going to dissolve non-polar. And what will not happen is that polar and non-polar will not mix. So they're not going to be very soluble. So polar dissolves polar, non-polar dissolves non-polar. Here's an example of two polar molecules. So for example, over here, water is a polar molecule. Oxygen, being very electronegative, is going to attract electrons, so it's going to have a partial negative charge. And this is an ammonia molecule, NH3. N being electronegative is going to pull the electrons towards itself, so that side would be negative, while the rest of the molecule would be having a partial positive charge. So two polar molecules are mixed with each other. So you can see I've mixed ammonia and water molecules, and they're now mixed with each other. Now, since all the molecules are polar, so they're going to attract each other. The positive side of one molecule would attract the negative side of the other molecule. The positive and negative, they would attract each other. So there's going to be lots of attraction between these molecules. They would all be attracting each other. The negative side would attract the positive side, and so on. So plenty of attraction between particles. This positive might be attracted to the negative of this molecule. So they would all be attracting each other. So if you mix them, they're going to attract each other and they're going to remain mixed. There would be no reason for them to not mix. So if two molecules, polar molecules, they attract each other and they have intermolecular forces, and they attract each other equally. So if they start attracting each other, they're going to, it would be easier for them to mix with each other. Now let's think of this other example. And I told you that polar and non-polar, they don't mix. So now I have a bromine molecule, a Br2 molecule, which is non-polar because the dipoles are going to get cancelled out. They're both equally electronegative, so the electrons would be evenly shared between the two atoms. So there would be no regions of partial positive and partial negative charges in bromine. Now, bromine molecule is mixed in water molecule, which is highly polar. So two different types of substances, one non-polar, one polar, are mixed together. Now, bromine molecules are going to have weak intermolecular forces because they don't have any dipoles. But water molecules are going to attract other water molecules very, very strongly. For example, this positive hydrogen would be attracted to the negative of that oxygen. And similarly, this positive hydrogen would be attracted to the negative of this water molecule. This water molecule, the negative part would be attracting the positive of the other water molecule. So they would all be attracted to each other very, very strongly. Whereas bromine, they would not be exhibiting very strong intermolecular forces. So water attracting other water molecules. And what would eventually happen is that all the bromine molecules, they would get pushed out because they would not be attracting the water molecules. So the water molecules would start attracting each other, and they would squeeze out all these bromine molecules out of the way, out of the path, and all the water molecules would start squeezing with each other. They would start attracting each other, and they would all get together to form a separate layer. So this now is a much better representation of how the state would be after a few moments. That all the water molecules, they would stick with each other and they would form a separate layer, and all the bromine molecules, they would get pushed away because bromine molecules were not attracting water molecules. So one molecule was polar, they were all attracting each other very strongly, they had strong intermolecular forces, and they ended up joining together to form a separate layer, and all the bromine particles, they got pushed away. So polar and non-polar, they will not mix with each other. Last example is non-polar substances mixing in non-polar solvents. So here I've mixed bromine in CCl4 solvent. Now both molecules are non-polar because all the Cl, they are going to have equal electronegativities, and according to the shape, the electron density would be evenly distributed between them. Similarly in bromine, both atoms are equally electronegative, so the electrons would be evenly distributed between the atoms. So there would be no regions of partial positive or partial negative charges. So you have all these non-polar molecules, and I've mixed them together, so all of them are right now mixed with each other. Now all these molecules, they're not really attracting each other very strongly. They're all non-polar molecules, so the forces of attraction or intermolecular forces are not going to be very strong. So they wouldn't be attracting each other very, very strongly, which is why if you mix them together, they don't have any reason to unmix. No two molecules are attracting each other very, very strongly to form a separate layer. So no separate layers would be formed. Both molecules are attracting each other equally. So if they're attracting each other equally, this bromine would be attracted to CCl4. It would also be attracted to the other bromine molecule with the same force. So if they are attracting each other with the same force, they would all remain mixed together once you mix them. And there would be no reason to form separate layers. Like in the previous case, two molecules would attract each other very, very strongly, which is why they would unmix. Like the previous case that we discussed over here, the water molecules were attracting each other very strongly, whereas the bromine molecules were not attracting each other very strongly, which is why all the water molecules were all sticking together to form a separate layer. So if both molecules are non-polar, then they would remain mixed, and there would be no reason for them to unmix. So non-polar are going to dissolve non-polar solvents. Property that depends on intermolecular forces is known as surface tension, specifically for liquids. Surface tension is that, for example, if you have liquid water, it is going to be difficult to penetrate water. It's going to resist penetration. So if you fall from a height into a pool, the water would act or would prevent penetration, and it's going to hit you very, very strongly. So insects would be able to walk on water because of this surface tension. And the reason why there is surface tension is that molecules of water are strongly attracting each other. So all these molecules, they are strongly attracted to one another. So if you try to penetrate this surface of water, it's going to be difficult. Not very difficult, but slightly difficult. So the water is going to exert an equal force upwards, and it's going to try and prevent penetration. So if you fall from a very high height into a pool or into a water surface, the surface prevents you from penetrating the water, and it's going to hit you very, very strongly because all the molecules are attracting each other. So it's going to be very difficult to move them apart so that you could penetrate the object, or if a person is diving, you could enter the liquid. Another important property of intermolecular forces is viscosity or stickiness of. So you can see this honey. Honey is very sticky. It tends to stick to other objects. So if particles have greater intermolecular forces, then they would have this tendency to stick and they would tend to stick to other objects. So greater intermolecular forces or greater interaction with other particles, more intermolecular forces means that substances would tend to be more viscous, and they would be very thick. They would tend not to flow very, very easily. Let's now quickly discuss the types of intermolecular forces that are going to exist between simple molecules. So they're not one type of intermolecular forces, but usually there are three types of intermolecular forces. These forces are, number one, permanent dipole interaction. Number two are hydrogen bonds. And number three, they're known as van der Waals forces, which are also given other names like London dispersion forces or Tempi dipole induced dipole interaction. So mainly these three forces, and relatively speaking, hydrogen bonds are one of the strongest force of attractions, whereas van der Waals forces, relatively speaking, are one of the weakest. So let's start with discussing the first type of interactive force, permanent dipole interaction. Now here is an HCl molecule. Permanent dipole interaction, a dipole indicates that the molecule is polar, it has two poles. So this force of attraction is in polar molecules. So for example, you have an HCl molecule. Chlorine is more electronegative, which basically means that the shared electrons would be closer to chlorine. So they're going to lie closer to chlorine. Chlorine has more protons. It has a more attractive force for electrons. So these shared electrons would be lying closer to chlorine, which would result in the formation of a slight or partial negative charge on chlorine. And H would become slightly electron deficient. So it's going to have a partial positive charge. So here I've drawn other HCl molecules. And so you have plenty of HCl molecules. And all of them are polar molecules. They have a permanent dipole. Permanent meaning that chlorine would always be electronegative, so this side would always have a higher electron density, more concentration of charge, whereas the other side would always be electron deficient. Now, when you have all these polar molecules, permanent dipoles, the negative part of one molecule would attract the positive H of the other HCl molecule. So this attraction, negative part would attract the positive H of the other molecule. This negative Cl will be attracted to the positive H of this HCl. The Cl negative would be attracted to H positive. So all these intermolecular forces between these molecules, they would be called permanent dipole interaction.
Now the first point is, how do you figure out whether permanent dipoles exist in molecules? So permanent dipoles are present when there's a difference in electronegativity between atoms. So whenever there's a difference in electronegativity, and the other point is that dipoles, they don't cancel out. We have discussed polar covalent molecules before as well, so I'll just give you a brief overview again. Over here, I have four molecules, a fluorine molecule, then a chlorine bonded to F, then a bromine bonded to F, and then an iodine bonded to F. The thing is that there's supposed to be a difference in electronegativity, which means electronegativity is the tendency for an atom to attract electrons. Now, in this first fluorine molecule, this fluorine is one of the most electronegative elements. So they're both trying to attract electrons. But the shared electrons, which are between over here, the bonded electrons, are going to remain evenly distributed. So there's not going to be any partial positive or partial negative charges. The electrons are not going to go to either fluorine, and they would remain evenly distributed. So it's going to be a nonpolar molecule. So nonpolar, no permanent dipoles. But look at this other molecule, ClF. So here I've drawn two ClF molecules, and remember fluorine. The top right corner of the periodic table, these are the elements that are more electronegative. So fluorine has a greater tendency to attract electrons, gain electrons. So it's going to result in a slight or partial negative charge on fluorine, whereas chlorine would have a partial positive charge. The other ClF molecule is also going to have a dipole. So there's going to be partial negative and partial positive charges, and the two molecules, the negative and positive sides, they're going to attract each other, and there would be permanent dipole interaction. But the strength of the permanent dipole attraction or interaction is not going to be very strong, because the dipole is going to be very, very small, because the difference in electronegativity is not very large. Now, quickly discussing this other molecule, BRF, the difference in electronegativity is now greater. Fluorine is a lot more electronegative compared to bromine. So The electrons are strongly attracted to fluorine, so it has a greater partial negative charge, resulting in a greater partial positive charge. And the other molecule also has the same. So the attractive forces between these molecules are now much greater. So the attractive force, the permanent dipole interaction is going to be stronger, and they're going to have greater melting and boiling points. Because of the greater partial positive, partial negative, because of the greater polarity on the molecule, due to a larger difference in electronegativity. This strength in dipole is even greater in this IF molecule, because the difference, iodine is not very electronegative, fluorine is a lot more electronegative. So the electrons are a lot strongly attracted to the fluorine atom, and resulting in a very strong partial negative charge and a very strong partial positive charge. So the attraction, or the permanent dipole attraction between these molecules is going to be a lot stronger. So the permanent dipole interaction depends on the polarity of the molecule, on the strength of the permanent dipole. So when you compare these molecules, the permanent dipole strength, or the attractive forces between the molecules, they are increasing as you go from CLF to BRF to iodine IF. The first molecule had no permanent dipole at all. The other thing to remember is that permanent dipole strength depends on the shape of the molecule as well. So for example, if you look at these two molecules, CO2 and sulfur dioxide, oxygen is very electronegative. It's on the right side, the top right corner of the periodic table. Now, the shape of the molecule is linear for carbon dioxide, because there's a double bond over here and a double bond over here, and they repel each other, which is why they would be 180 degrees apart. One oxygen on one side, the other bond would be repelled by the repulsion from these electrons, and it would be on exactly the opposite side, so 180 degrees. Now, in this case, this electron is trying to pull electrons, this oxygen is trying to pull electrons on the right, this oxygen is trying to pull electrons towards the left. The force of attraction would get cancelled out. The electrons would remain evenly distributed. They're neither going to go towards this oxygen or this oxygen. So it's going to be a non-polar molecule with no permanent dipoles. But if you look at a similar molecule, sulfur dioxide, the shape of the molecule is bent, because sulfur has these extra lone pairs which are going to exert repulsion. And because of those repulsion, actually sulfur only has one lone pair. So that's the lone pair of sulfur. The bonds would be pointing sort of downwards because of the lone pair repulsion. It's going to push the bonds downwards. Now, this shape is non-linear, and the angles are around 117 degrees. But now, the force of attraction, both oxygens are trying to pull electrons downwards. The net result would be the dipoles would not cancel out, because the electrons are getting pulled downwards, which would mean that the bottom side of the molecule would have a partial negative charge, whereas this sulfur atom at the top is going to have a partial positive charge, which would result in a polar molecule. So the shape of the molecule is very, very important. It's going to also decide the strength of the dipole that's going to be formed, or whether the dipole is going to get cancelled out. Let's just focus on a few more molecules and see what shape, what effect shape is going to have. So you have nitrogen bonded with, let's make this fluorine. So it's nitrogen bonded with fluorine, and all fluorines are pointing downwards because of the lone pair. The bonds are pointing downwards like a pyramid, and fluorine being more electronegative would be pulling electrons downwards. All the fluorines would be attracting electrons very strongly, which would result in a partial negative charge on these fluorine atoms, and the nitrogen is going to be relatively partial positive because the electrons are going to be dragged downwards. Whereas this other molecule of aluminium fluoride, aluminium has no lone pair, so the fluorine atoms would be arranged in a fan-shaped manner, and again, fluorine is more electronegative, so they would be pulling electrons. But in this case, the force of attraction would get cancelled out. This one is all fluorines are pulling electrons at a 120 degree angle in a planar molecule, and the forces are going to get cancelled out. So this molecule overall is not going to have a dipole. Let's talk about another type of intermolecular force, which would be called hydrogen bonds. Remember, although the word bond appears in the name, but it's an intermolecular force. It's going to be a force of attraction between molecules. So what's a hydrogen bond? It's an extreme version of a dipole. So it's similar to a dipole, but an extreme version of a dipole, and it is significantly stronger.
The force of attraction is significantly stronger. So molecules having hydrogen bonds, they would have significantly stronger, higher melting and boiling points. Now here's a graph that I've posted, which is showing boiling point trends of different groups and their halides. And you would notice that these molecules over here, they have very high boiling points. These are the ones that specifically have hydrogen bonds, intermolecular force. For example, if you look at the group 7 halides, HF, the red one, you notice that HF has significantly higher boiling point compared to HCl, HBr, or HI. So any compound that has hydrogen bonds has significantly higher boiling point trends, and it would not follow the trend. The same with NH3 group 5 halides, the green ones, relatively lower boiling points. NH3 all of a sudden has higher boiling point. Same is the case with water, having a much greater boiling point compared to the other group 6 halides. So these compounds specifically have hydrogen bonding intermolecular force. Now I'm going to talk about what is hydrogen bonds. Now there are two conditions that are required for hydrogen bonding to occur. First one is that H should be bonded directly to one of the most electronegative elements, nitrogen, oxygen, or fluorine. And the other condition is that the lone pairs on nitrogen, oxygen, or fluorine, they should be available. So these two conditions, if they are met, then the molecule possibly can have hydrogen bonds. Now let's have a look at HF molecule, which is fulfilling the above two conditions. That H is directly bonded to F, and there are lone pairs that are available. Fluorine has 3 lone pairs in its outer shell. It has a total of 7 electrons. Now this HF bond is going to be very, very polar, because the electrons over here in this bond, they would be strongly attracted to fluorine. Fluorine is probably one of the most electronegative elements, and that would result in the creation of this partial positive and partial negative charge. Now this partial positive and partial negative charge, it's going to be a highly polar molecule. The positive charge is going to be very large, and the negative charge on fluorine is going to be very large, because fluorine is extremely electronegative, pulling the electrons towards itself. But in this molecule, another thing that's happening is that the lone pair charge density increases the negative charge, because there are lots of lone pairs. And remember, fluorine is a very small atom. This would not be possible with chlorine, bromine, or iodine. Fluorine is a very small atom, so these lone pairs are very concentrated. The negative charge over here is very concentrated, which increases the negative charge density on this fluorine. So not only fluorine has a partial negative charge because the electrons are unequally distributed, because fluorine being more electronegative, but because of the lone pairs, the negative charge is even greater. So it's not just polar, it's an extremely polar molecule. Similarly, the other molecule of HF is going to be highly polar in exactly the same way. So the force of attraction between the negative and the positive H is going to be very strong between two molecules. So it's going to be a very strong force of attraction, and this would be referred to as hydrogen bonding. So extremely strong force of attraction between these molecules, one HF molecule and another HF molecule. The same pretty much applies to this water molecule as well. This is also fulfilling the condition that the highly electronegative oxygen, nitrogen, or fluorine, in this case oxygen, is bonded to hydrogen, and they are lone pairs on oxygen. And these, again, oxygen is a small atom, so this negative charge would be very concentrated. The bonds are going to be highly polar because oxygen is very electronegative, but the negative charge would be very strong, reason being because these lone pairs exist, and the concentrated negative charge on the small atom is going to be even greater. So it's going to be a highly polar molecule, and the lone pairs would have a negative charge, the H would have a positive charge, and the negative and the positive part, the part of the molecules, they're going to attract each other. So you'll be asked to draw these molecules and to show hydrogen bonding. So lone pairs on one oxygen would be attracted to the positive hydrogen on the other water molecule. And a similar thing happens with the ammonia molecules, N, highly electronegative N, bonded with H, and with its lone pairs. Now again, these lone pairs having a very strong negative charge, electronegative N pulling all the electrons, so it's a highly polar molecule. Plus the negative charge even becomes even greater because of this high charge density, negative charge density over here. So the other molecule is going to be exactly the same. Lone pair is negative, H would be all positive. And the lone pair and the H, they will be attracted to each other.
Now here's a slightly different molecule. It's an ethanol molecule. Now the entire molecule is not really involved in forming hydrogen bonds. Only this part over here. Remember the O and H, if they are bonded together and the lone pairs are present, that's when hydrogen bonding occurs. So this side not involved in hydrogen bonding. It's a non-polar side chain. Carbon and hydrogen have almost similar electronegativity. So there's no polarity over here. But over here, the lone pairs are highly negative charge density over here, and the H would be positive. The same is the scenario over here in this other ethanol molecule. H being positive, the H which is next to O, and the lone pairs being negative. And then oppositely charged parts of the molecule, they're going to attract each other, and these dotted lines, these are the forces of attraction, which would be called hydrogen bonding. So in this molecule, the rest of the molecule not involved in hydrogen bonding, but the OH part that will be involved in hydrogen bonding. Now here's another example of two molecules that are going to be connected to each other or attracted to each other via hydrogen bonds. So what were the conditions for hydrogen bonding? That N must be bonded to H. So you can see all these nitrogens, they are bonded to H, which is going to result in the formation of this highly polar bond. N having a partial negative charge, the H would have a very strong partial positive charge. So this is the polar NH bond. And the other condition was that lone pairs must be available, so you on nitrogen or oxygen. So there's oxygen over here as well. So you have all these lone pairs available, the negative charge, the concentrated negative charge that is available. So the positive H would be attracted to these lone pairs, the negatively charged lone pairs with high charge density. Same over here, the negatively charged lone pairs would be attracted to the positive H. This oxygen lone pairs having a partial negative charge, the H positive would be attracted. So there would be three hydrogen bonds between these two molecules. This is guanine and this is cytosine, although you don't really need to know this for AS right now, but they're part of DNA. And they're part of a DNA structure where two chains are connected together by hydrogen bonds. So you can see the hydrogen bonds that are being formed between the two molecules. These are the intermolecular forces that are going to exist between a cytosine base and a guanine base. Now there's certain properties, especially of water, that are affected by hydrogen bonds because water forms hydrogen bonds. The number one property is that ice, when water freezes and it forms ice, it expands when it freezes. So here's an example of water that has frozen in a bottle, and you can see that some of the ice is coming out, which means that the water, liquid water in the bottle, is expanding, so which is why it's coming out. And freezing of ice causes a lot of problems, especially bursting of pipes during winters. So this is a huge problem. So we'll now discuss why that happens and why hydrogen bonding is responsible for that. Now this image over here is a good representation of what's happening. As you can see over here, this is liquid water. The molecules are close together. And over here, this is frozen ice, and the molecules are further apart. And I'm going to now tell you why that happens. Here are a bunch of molecules in liquid state. Now in liquid state, the molecules are energetic. So that means these molecules can sort of move around and slide past each other. They can also rotate around and continue moving around. So all these molecules are just bumping into each other and consciously just moving around randomly. Now in liquid state, there would be considerable hydrogen bonding. The positive hydrogen and the negative part of oxygen, they would be attracted to each other. But again, the molecules are energetic, so they are not going to remain stationary. They can easily overcome those attractive forces. So when water freezes, the molecules are going to start losing energy, and they are previously randomly moving around, but now they would not be able to overcome the hydrogen bonds. And hydrogen bonds are the attractive forces between the molecules, between the positive and negative sides of the molecules. They are going to become more significant. So what's going to happen is that previously this molecule was randomly just moving around, but now it's losing energy. The negative part of this molecule will get attracted to the positive side of the other molecule, and they would this force of attraction
is going to become more significant. This molecule could not just move around now because it has lost energy. The same would happen with all the other molecules as well. So for example, this molecule was also previously just randomly moving around, overcoming the intermolecular forces, but now it has lost energy. And the intermolecular forces have now become more significant. The negative part of this water molecule will be attracted to the positive of the other water molecule, and they would start sticking to each other in a very organized manner. And this molecule also losing energy, and as it loses energy, the positive of this molecule will be attracted to the negative part of the other molecule. And as you can see now that the arrangement is now more crystalline, and there are more gaps being created. Now it's a more organized structure. So that is what happens when water freezes, which is why gaps are being created. And these gaps lead to the expansion of ice. So coming back to our diagram, you can see over here previously liquid water, the molecules were all just bumping around with each other. And the hydrogen bonds, the attractive forces between the molecules were easily overcome. But once the molecules lose energy, they arrange themselves according to hydrogen bonds, which is why the gaps are created and the structure of ice starts to expand. And not only does it expand, its density is also lesser. You can see ice floating because the molecules are now less packed. Density is mass over volume, so volume is bigger, but the mass remains the same. So density of ice also decreases. Similarly, other properties of water are that it has significant surface tension as well. The molecules are all sticking to each other, so there is some attractive force, which is why sometimes it's very hard to actually penetrate water. If you slap water very strongly, you would feel a force because the water molecules are all sticking together. They don't allow anything to enter water, which is why things tend to float on water. It has significant surface tension. Leaves, etc., ships, etc., they're able to float on water because all the water molecules, they're all sticking to each other by the attractive force of hydrogen bonding. Let's now talk about the third type of intermolecular forces, which are known as van der Waals forces. There are other names as well. These are called dispersion forces or London dispersion forces, or the more technical name, which is temporary dipole-induced dipole interaction. One very important fact about van der Waals forces is that it's present in all molecules. So irrespective if the molecule has permanent dipoles or whether it has hydrogen bonds or any other force, it's going to be present in that particular molecule. It's also one of the weakest intermolecular force compared to hydrogen bonds or permanent dipoles, which are much stronger. Van der Waals forces are one of the weakest intermolecular force, and it's usually most significant in bigger molecules. So usually van der Waals forces really does matter. In bigger molecules, it depends on the size of the molecule. So if the molecule is bigger, there's going to be stronger van der Waals forces. And sometimes van der Waals forces, if the molecule is big enough, van der Waals forces would be more dominant compared to hydrogen bonds or permanent dipoles. And another point about them is because they're one of the weakest intermolecular forces, they are usually discussed when other types of intermolecular forces are absent. For example, if a molecule has hydrogen bonds, then the property of that particular molecule would be dependent on the hydrogen bonds because hydrogen bonds are significantly stronger compared to van der Waals forces. So the property of the molecule or the behavior of the molecule depends on hydrogen bonds rather than on van der Waals forces. So van der Waals forces are usually not discussed and they usually only matter when other types of intermolecular forces are absent, which means that only van der Waals forces are present in a molecule. And remember that they are more significant in bigger molecules. So smaller molecules, and if there are other types of intermolecular forces present, then the property of the molecule depends on those other types of intermolecular forces rather than hydrogen bonds. So let's quickly discuss what are hydrogen van der Waals forces. Now here you have bromine molecule. The three bromine molecules, and they have very strong van der Waals forces between them. Apparently, these bromine molecules are nonpolar, which basically means that the electrons that are being shared over here, both bromines are equally electronegative. Both bromines are trying to pull these electrons towards themselves, but the forces of attraction are going to get cancelled out because the dipoles are going to get cancelled out. The electrons would remain evenly shared between the two bromine atoms because both bromines are pulling those electrons equally, one towards the right, the other one towards the left. So the electrons remain evenly distributed, and there are no dipoles. So let's rub these dipoles out. So this molecule has no partial positive or partial negative charge. There is no permanent dipole. So the question is, how does one bromine molecule attract the other bromine molecule? So what's happening is that this bromine molecule is constantly bumping around with the other bromine molecules, and during these collisions, what happens is that the electrons, the shared electrons, might get knocked to either side. They might get knocked to the right, or they might get knocked to the left. So during these collisions, the electrons would, the molecules would collide, and electron cloud that was evenly distributed between the two bromine atoms might get knocked to one side. So let's assume that the electron cloud gets knocked to the right. If it gets knocked to the right, this bromine would get a partial negative charge, the other bromine would get a partial positive charge. So the electrons would be slightly towards one bromine, but remember, this is only happening for a very temporary instant during a collision where the electron cloud might get knocked to one side. Now, once this bromine is partial negative, what it would do is that it would induce charges on the other bromine molecule, because due to the negative charge on this bromine, the electrons over here are going to get knocked away, they're going to get repelled. So this bromine will get a partial negative charge, this bromine will get a partial positive charge. And the same pretty much would happen with this bromine molecule. A charge would be induced on this bromine molecule as well. The negative charge over here is going to repel the electrons over here. So these electrons would get repelled because of the negative charge of the neighboring bromine. And the same thing would happen. This bromine will get a partial negative charge. This bromine will get a partial positive charge. This is the reason why it's called temporary dipole-induced dipole interaction, because a temporary dipole for a very minute instant formed on one molecule would induce dipoles on the other molecule. Now, all the molecules are temporary polar. So the negative side of this molecule will attract the positive side of the other molecule. The negative side of this molecule will attract the positive side of the other molecule. So just like permanent dipoles, there's going to be a force of attraction, but remember, it's going to be a temporary force of attraction for a very temporary instant. And these forces of attraction would be called van der Waals forces. But in the very next instance, the electron cloud over here during another collision might get knocked to the left. So what happens then? So let's now assume that the electrons are getting knocked to the left. This bromine becomes partial negative, this bromine becomes partial positive. So another temporary dipole is formed in the very next instant. This is a positive bromine, so it's going to attract the electrons now. The electrons in the shared electrons over here, they're going to get attracted by the positive bromine. So this side would become partial negative, this side would become partial positive, because all the electrons would be slightly closer to this bromine. The same pretty much would happen. This bromine is positive, so it's going to attract the electrons over here, and these electrons would be attracted slightly. This side would become partial negative, this side would become partial positive. So the same thing repeats. So no matter which way the electrons get knocked, no matter how the temporary dipole is formed, an induced dipole would be formed accordingly, and the force of attraction would still be there. The partial positive of one bromine will attract the partial negative of the other bromine. The partial positive of one bromine will attract the partial negative of the other bromine molecule. So the van der Waals forces would still be there. But remember, this is a very random process. The dipoles formed, the temporary dipoles formed, would be formed in a completely random manner. And the induced dipoles formed would also be forming in a completely random manner. So there would be fluctuating dipoles, left, right, depending on where the electrons get knocked. But there would always be some dipoles forming, some temporary dipoles forming, and there would always be some induced dipoles forming. And there would always be this force of attraction between these molecules, which may not be as strong as hydrogen bonds or permanent dipoles, but it would always be existing between these molecules. Now, one very important thing that these van der Waals forces, or the strength of these van der Waals forces, depends on, it depends on the size of the molecule. So, for example, I take a bigger molecule. Remember, bromine is a liquid at room temperature, so the force of attraction is strong. The molecules are close together, sticking to each other, but not strong enough. It's in liquid state. Compare that to an iodine molecule. So here are a bunch of iodine molecules. Same thing happens. For some random reason, the electrons get knocked to one side. This side would become partial negative. This side would become partial positive. The negative side would repel the electrons in the neighboring molecule, and the electrons would be knocked away. And this side would become partial negative. This side would become partial positive. And the same pretty much happens with the electrons over here. The negative charge is going to repel the electrons over here. and this side would become partial negative, this side would become partial positive, and there's going to be a force of attraction between them called van der Waals forces. The positive and negative ends of the molecules will attract each other. The positive negative ends of the molecule will attract each other. Temporary dipoles formed, which would induce dipoles on the other molecules. Now, coming back, iodine is a solid, which means the strength of van der Waals forces, the strength of attraction between these molecules is a lot stronger. So what is the reason? What is the number one factor in which on which the van der Waals forces depend on? And that factor is the size of the molecule. So the bigger the molecule, the more electron it has, the more the van der Waals force. The reason is that if you look at a bromine molecule has a total of 35 electrons for one bromine, 35 with the other one. So the total number of electrons is 70. But if you look at an iodine molecule, 53 plus 53, that's a total of 106 electrons. So just imagine 53 electrons fluctuating, creating dipoles. The strength of positive and negative charges would not be as much as 106 electrons fluctuating and creating dipoles. For example, if 106 electrons get slightly knocked to one side, the negative charge would be much stronger compared to 70 electrons getting knocked to one side, creating negative charge on one side. So greater number of electrons, that would result in greater amount of dipoles or stronger dipoles. So the number one factor is that the bigger the molecule, the more electron it has, the greater its van der Waals forces. So this diagram over here shows a trend in melting and boiling points of halogens, group 7 halogens, so fluorine, chlorine, bromine and iodine. Fluorine being the smallest molecule has the least van der Waals forces, so its melting and boiling points are pretty low. Chlorine is a bigger molecule, bromine and iodine, they are much bigger molecules, so the melting and boiling points, they depend on the size of the molecule. So bigger molecules have more van der Waals forces. The second factor that van der Waals forces is dependent on is the surface area. So the greater the surface area, more is the van der Waals force. Now this factor really comes into play for organic molecules. Now here I have two organic molecules. Both of them are C5H12. One is a straight chain molecule at C5H12. And the other one is also C5H12, but it's a branched molecule. It has 5 carbon atoms, but they're all huddled together. They're all close to each other. Now, the first molecule has a greater surface area. The electron cloud is much more spread out. The second molecule, the electron cloud would be a lot more concentrated, huddled together. They would all be close to each other. So this one over here, it has a greater surface area. So there are more chances of this molecule, which is much bigger in size, it would be interacting with other molecules more frequently, more collisions would occur. So there would be more chances of temporary dipole induced dipoles forming in this bigger molecule compared to this smaller molecule. The smaller molecule, the smaller surface area, the one with the smaller surface area, would not be interacting with the other molecules that much. So there would be fewer temporary dipole induced dipoles formed in this much smaller molecule. So this second factor really comes into play in organic chemistry. So remember, the long chains, straight chain molecules are going to have van der Waals forces irrespective of the fact that both of them are exactly the same size. So this molecule over here is going to have a higher melting point, a higher boiling point, etc. And I've also checked the boiling points of pentane is 36.1 degrees centigrade, whereas the boiling point of 2,3-dimethylpropane is 10 degrees centigrade. So greater surface area is going to have a higher boiling point. Very popular question comes about explaining the trend in boiling points of hydrogen halides. You have HF, HCl, HBr, and HI. Now, the first one over here, HF, that is due to hydrogen bonding. Remember, HF molecules, they form significant hydrogen bonding. They have significant hydrogen bonds, so the melting and boiling points are much greater. But related to van der Waals, it's this trend over here that you can see over here, that HI has a stronger boiling point, or has a higher boiling point compared to HCl. And they ask you, why is that the scenario? Now, these three molecules, HCl, HBr, and HI, are polar molecules because chlorine, bromine, and iodine are all electronegative. Chlorine being the most electronegative, so the dipole created would be a lot stronger compared to the rest because Cl is highly electronegative, so the electrons would be closer to Cl. Bromine down the group electronegativity slightly decreases, so bromine's dipole would be slightly weaker, and iodine's dipole, HI's dipole would be even lesser in strength. because electronegativity of these elements is decreasing down the group, Cl being the most electronegative. Now, HCl has the strongest permanent dipole. It has the strongest permanent dipole. So it should have the highest boiling point, but that is not the case. So strongest dipole, there should be more attraction. There should be more attraction. It would be more difficult for HCl to boil. But the thing is that HCl is a smaller molecule. HI is comparatively a bigger molecule. So what's happening down the group is, the reason why the boiling points are actually increasing is because of van der Waals forces. I told you that van der Waals forces are always present and they're more significant in larger molecules. So although this molecule over here has permanent dipoles, but the molecule would be bumping with other molecules. And the dipoles, there would be temporary dipole-induced dipoles being created on this molecule. And there would be significant van der Waals forces. So bigger molecules are going to have more van der Waals forces. So the reason why HI has a greater boiling point is, so it has lesser permanent dipoles, but it has significantly greater van der Waals forces due to larger size, which is why HI has a higher boiling point compared to HCl. Even though HCl has more permanent dipoles, but it has a stronger dipole, but the fluctuation, the temporary dipole-induced dipoles being formed in this molecule would be lesser because there are only a total of 18 electrons over here. Over here, there are a total of 54 electrons, so any fluctuation in dipoles, that would be more significant, and the van der Waals forces or the strength of van der Waals forces is going to be greater for HI.
Following lecture, we're now going to study the types of chemical bonds and structures that you're going to encounter in chemistry. So the first type of structure or bonding is called ionic bonds. Ionic bonds are formed between metals and non-metals, but not specifically. It's basically between an electropositive element which likes to lose electrons and an electronegative element which likes to gain electrons. So here is your typical periodic table, and you can see over here the ones elements on the right side, these are the ones that are more electronegative. They have a tendency to gain electrons. The more protons towards the right, the number of protons increase, so the tendency for elements to gain electrons increases. And the elements to the left, the ones lighter in the shade, they're the ones that like to lose electrons. So ionic bonds are formed between electropositive elements that like to lose electrons and electronegative elements that have a tendency to gain electrons. So this is what basically happens when an ionic bond is formed. For example, sodium and chlorine being the more electronegative element, it's on the right side. Sodium is on the left side of the periodic table. It's a metal. It likes to lose electrons. Chlorine likes to gain electrons. Now, chlorine has an incomplete outer shell. So it needs one electron, so it would try to gain electrons. It has more protons. Sodium, on the other hand, has fewer protons. It has a tendency to lose electrons. So what would eventually happen is that sodium would lose its outer electron, the one that is really far away. It's not holding that electron very strongly. So that electron would be lost and gained by chlorine. As a result, sodium would get a plus one charge, a positive one charge. It would become an ion. A sodium cation would be formed. And chlorine ends up gaining electrons, so it gets a minus one charge. A chlorine or chloride cation is formed, anion is formed. Negatively charged ions are called anions. And there would be a force of attraction between positively charged and negatively charged ions. That would be called your ionic bond. So positive ions attracting negative ions, and that is precisely what happens during ionic bonding. Here is another example of an ionic bond that's being formed. Over here you can see an oxygen atom. Oxygen is again very electronegative. It has a very high tendency to gain electrons. So oxygen has 6 electrons in its outer shell. It needs 2 electrons. So what it does is that it takes sodium and it brings in 2 sodium. Sodium's group 1 metals, they like to lose electrons. So sodium has 1 electron in its outer shell. It ends up losing that electron. Another sodium atom ends up losing another electron because oxygen needs a total of 2 electrons. So this is what the ionic dot and cross diagram would look like. Sodium would lose its outer electrons. Both sodiums will have a plus one charge. This one will also have a plus one charge because it has lost one electron. Oxygen ends up gaining 2 electrons, which is why it has a negative 2 charge. So the positively charged ions and the negatively charged anions, they would be attracting each other, and that would be your ionic bond. Now this is an example of MgO, magnesium, group 2 element. Oxygen group 6, oxygen highly electronegative, needs 2 electrons, so ends up stealing the 2 outer electrons from magnesium. Remember, only the outer electrons are lost. The rest of the electrons are strongly held by the atom, so they would have little chance of getting lost. The outer electrons are the ones that are usually lost. So Mg gives oxygen two electrons. Oxygen ends up stealing those two electrons. Mg gets a 2 plus charge. It forms a positively charged cation, whereas oxygen ends up gaining the two electrons from magnesium and gets a negative 2 charge. So a magnesium ion and an oxygen ion is formed. And there would be strong electrostatic force of attraction between magnesium ions and oxygen ions. Let's also briefly discuss what makes a strong ionic bond. So smaller ions, remember this, smaller ions would be closer together, so there would be more attraction. And the greater the charge, the stronger would be the bond. So smaller ions having greater charge, also referred to as ions having high charge density, which means a smaller ion having greater charge is going to exert a stronger force of attraction. So for example, I have these two ions. I have Na plus 1 and Cl minus 1, NaCl. They are attracting each other. But the charges, this electrostatic force of attraction between positively charged ions and negatively charged ions, the charges are not very large, plus 1 and minus 1, so the attraction is weaker. Whereas compare this to an MgO ionic bond, Mg2 plus, OH2 minus, so the force of attraction would be a lot stronger compared to NaCl. They have roughly the same sizes, almost the same sizes. So greater charge would lead to stronger attraction. So for example, if you had aluminium in this case, aluminium is 3 plus, so the force of attraction would be even stronger. The other factor that we discussed was the size of the ion. So Na plus and F minus 1 are smaller ions. So smaller ions are closer together, so the force of attraction would be stronger. There would be stronger force of attraction because force of attraction depends on how far the ions are from each other. So smaller ions are closer together, more packed together, so the electrostatic attraction would be stronger. Bigger ions, for example, you have a KCl ionic compound. K plus 1 and Cl minus 1 are bigger ions. So they would be further from each other. They are bigger in size. The charge density is lesser. The charge is less concentrated. So the force of attraction between the two ions would be weaker. So size of ion is also a factor. The nuclei of the two atoms would be further away from each other if the ion is bigger. So the force of attraction would be lesser. Now we will quickly define what charge density is. Charge density is defined as charge over volume or charge over radius. So basically, if there's a bigger ion with a bigger radius and having a smaller charge, its charge density is lesser. So the charge is spread out over a much bigger area and the charge would be less effective. Plus one charge would be weaker. On the other hand, if the charge is concentrated over the smaller area or the charge itself is bigger in size, then the charge density is higher. This charge is going to be more effective if it's concentrated at a particular or in a small area. So the smaller the radius, greater the charge density is going to be greater, and the charge would be much more, or the ion would be much more effective. Its charge would be much more effective and it would strongly attract or repel other ions or charges. Let's now also discuss the type of structure that ionic compounds form. These are called giant ionic lattices. Now here's your typical ionic lattice. What happens is that, for example, if you have NaCl, NaCl is Na plus 1 and Cl minus 1. But in an ionic compound, it's not just one sodium ion and one Cl ion. It's basically thousands of billions of sodium ions and Cl ions all sticking to each other, all attracting each other. So anions and cations alternate, and there's a large number of positive and negative ions held together in a three-dimensional lattice. And each is held together strongly by electrostatic force of attraction. So one negative ion surrounded by positive ions are surrounded by negative ions. So they are all attracted to each other. So this diagram over here shows a two-dimensional picture, a slice of this three-dimensional cubic lattice. Sodium ions surrounded by Cl ions. Cl ions are surrounded by sodium ions, and this structure repeats over and over again, which is why it's a giant structure. It's a giant endless structure, and they form these tiny crystals with billions or trillions of sodium ions and Cl ions all sticking to each other. Plus, the arrangement of these ions also depends on the quantity or the ratio. So whenever you write an ionic compound, for example, if you write NaCl, it tells you the ratio of the ions in the lattice. So NaCl, the ratio is 1:1.
So for every one sodium ion, there's one Cl ion. So if there are 1,000 sodium ions, there would be 1,000 Cl ions. So the ionic compound, the formula is telling you the ratio of the ions in the compound. It's not the actual number, but the ratio of the ions in the compound. And the shape and structure of the lattice or the arrangement of the ions depends on the quantity of the ions, the ratio, as well as the sizes. So if the Cl ion is bigger in size, then the sodium ions surrounding it would be arranged in a different manner. So it depends on the ratio of the sizes of the two ions that are sticking to each other or that are attracting each other with strong electrostatic forces or attraction. We're going to quickly discuss some properties of ionic compounds and physical properties based on the structure of these ionic compounds. So the first one is that they have high melting and boiling points, which indicates that they are strong attractive forces or bonds between the positively and negatively charged ions. And also, since these are giant structures, so the bonds are larger in quantity. So if you want to melt NaCl, you have to give sodium ion enough energy to overcome the attractive forces, but you have to give all the sodium ions, there would be lots of ionic bonds or forces of attraction that need to be overcome, which is why the melting and boiling points are usually higher. And also the melting and boiling points depends on the strength of the ionic bond. So for example, sodium ions and F-1, they would not be attracting each other very strongly because the charge density is lesser. So it would be easier to melt NaF apart. It would be very difficult to melt MgO because the charge density is much greater. It's much higher. Mg is 2 plus, O is 2 minus. So the force of attraction is much stronger. So the melting and boiling points are higher, but the strength varies depending on the strength of the ionic lattice. The second property is that most ionic compounds are crystalline solids at room temperature. And we've already discussed that they form a crystal lattice. But the important point is that ionic compounds are hard and brittle. So why are ionic compounds? They're very hard, but if you apply a sufficient amount of force, they are brittle and they break very easily. For example, a salt crystal, it appears to be strong, and it usually is strong. Even marble, etc., these are very strong. But if you apply sufficient force, then they simply break apart, and they're very brittle. So why are they brittle? So here's your typical ionic lattice, positive and negative ions all sticking to each other, strong electrostatic force of attraction. And let's say there's a force applied. Now, they're not going to break very easily. So we're applying sufficient force, and when you apply sufficient force, then these ions would slightly slip. And if they slip, so let's say these ions, they start to slightly slide and slip. And if they even slightly slip and you're applying this force, the arrangement changes. And if the arrangement changes, look over here, what happens? Even if they slightly slip, the two negative ions are now next to each other. If they're next to each other, they're not going to attract each other. They're going to repel each other. So the two positive ions are also next to each other. The two negative ions are also next to each other. And in this way, this piece of lattice would get repelled. It would break away. The other piece would also get repelled, and they're going to split and crack. So crystal lattices, even a small amount of force is applied, and if the lattice slightly changes, it breaks very easily, because even if the ions slightly slip, and two negative ions or two positive ions, they come in front of each other, then there would be a force of repulsion that would be created, and the lattice would no longer be sticking to each other, but they would get repelled, and the two pieces would just break apart. So this is the reason why ionic compounds are usually very brittle. Now, the last point when we're discussing properties of ionic compounds are that they conduct electricity when they are molten or dissolved in water. They don't conduct electricity when they are solids. Now, electricity is the movement of charges.
Ionic compounds have charged particles. You can see negatively charged and positively charged ions. So electricity is the movement of charges. But in solid state, the particles cannot move around. So these ions, these charged particles, they cannot move around in solid state. They can only move around in when they are either molten, which means that they are so energetic that they could freely just slip and slide, or whether they are in aqueous state. So here in this diagram, you can see the ionic compound, initially the ions cannot move around, they are tightly held together. In molten state, they are able to move around, that requires higher temperature. So
the charged particles can move around and slip and slide over one another, or when they are dissolved in water. What happens when you dissolve an ionic compound in water is you break the lattice. For example, you have a salt lattice, which is NaCl. You break the lattice into pieces and you mix it in water. So the ions get surrounded by water molecules. These green and blue ones are water molecules. These water molecules are surrounding the ions, which is why the positively charged and negatively charged ions, they can just move around wherever they like to go. So in aqueous state and in molten state, the ions can freely move around, but not in solid state. So next conduction could be possible in aqueous state or in molten state.
Next type of structures that we're going to discuss are called or known as simple covalent molecules. These type of structures usually exist when nonmetals bond with other nonmetals. So here I have two fluorine atoms together in front of each other. And remember, it's a nonmetal versus a nonmetal. That's when covalent molecules or covalent bonding happens. The reason why covalent bonding happens is this fluorine over here has 7 electrons. So it basically is looking for one electron. So it sees the fluorine, other fluorine atom's electron, and would try to grab that electron. But the problem is this fluorine over here also needs one electron. It has 7 electrons. So if it sees the electron from the other fluorine atom, it's going to try and pull that electron towards itself. Now the issue with nonmetals is that all nonmetals are electronegative, which means that they tend to gain electrons, but they don't tend to lose electrons. So both fluorines are trying to pull each other's electrons, and what would eventually happen is that the two electrons would be stuck in the middle. They would neither be able to go to the right or to the left. Both fluorines would be pulling each other's electrons equally. So what's going to eventually happen is that both fluorines, the electrons would be equally pulled towards each other, and the two electrons are going to be stuck in the middle. They would neither be able to go to the right or to the left. So both fluorines are trying to pull electrons, and that's when sharing happens. None of the fluorines are able to lose or gain electrons, but instead they end up sharing those electrons because of the equal force of attraction that they're exerting. Both elements are equally attracting those electrons. So that's how covalent molecules or simple covalent molecules are formed. And in this way, this fluorine is able to gain one electron. This fluorine is also able to gain one electron. Other covalent molecule, for example, this is an HCl molecule. Cl is trying to gain an electron from H, whereas H is trying to pull Cl's electron. So both electrons are stuck in the middle. Neither is able to gain those electrons, and they're sharing electrons. The same is the case with a water molecule, where oxygen needs two electrons. It tries to pull hydrogen's electron from both sides, but hydrogen is also pulling on oxygen's electrons, trying to gain its electron. So the electrons eventually are stuck in the middle. They're being shared. The same is the scenario with NH3. NH3 has, N has 5 electrons. It needs 3 electrons, pulls one from H, pulls another from another H, pulls another one from another H. But H is not letting go of its electrons, so the electrons are stuck in the middle, they're being shared. And so is the case with CH4. So all these elements, these compounds, these molecules, are simple covalent molecules. Now we will also briefly discuss what is meant by the term simple molecular structure. So we've discussed that covalent molecules are formed, but what do they look like in their structural form? So if you have a water molecule, there would be a bunch of water molecules, and they would all be they would not be bonded to each other, like in the case of ionic bonding that we discussed earlier. So simple molecules would exist independently. Each covalent molecule would be an independent unit, but there would be some slight intermolecular forces between these molecules. They would somehow be attracting each other very, very slightly. We have already previously discussed in other lectures what those intermolecular forces are. They could be permanent dipoles, they could be hydrogen bonds, or they could be van der Waals forces, depending on the type of molecule. But these intermolecular forces are usually very weak. Now these intermolecular forces, they could be very strong. If they're very strong, then all of them would be sticking together and it would be in solid state. But most of the time, these intermolecular forces are usually weak, and the molecules can randomly, this molecule over here could freely just move around or slip and slide. And if the intermolecular forces are extremely weak, then they would be in gaseous state and the molecules could move freely in all directions. So usually, simple molecular structures or covalent molecules have low melting and boiling points because they would usually be in liquid state or in gaseous state. The molecules would be moving around independently. This molecule over here would be moving freely in different directions. So if they have enough energy to overcome these very weak intermolecular forces. But remember, at times these intermolecular forces can also be strong, so they could also be in solid state. But generally, compared to other structures, simple covalent structures are going to have low melting and boiling points.
Another property of these covalent molecules is that they don't conduct electricity. So there is no electricity conduction, and the reason is that there are no charged particles. They don't form ions or electrons, so there are no charged particles, there are no moving particles that can carry charges. So these molecules over here, although they can freely move around, but they're not carrying any charge, they're completely neutral molecules. They're not losing or gaining electrons, so they're not forming ions, which is why no electricity conduction is possible with covalent molecules. The last property of these molecules is that the solubility in water, it varies. Some molecules are soluble, whereas other molecules are not very soluble. So for example, molecules like HCl, NH3, H2SO4, almost all acids, they are very soluble in water. And we have discussed this in intermolecular forces that water forms hydrogen bonds. So molecules that can form hydrogen bonds or are polar molecules, they're going to be attracted to water and they're going to mix with water. So when it comes to covalent molecules, molecules that are polar or can form hydrogen bonds, they're usually soluble in water. Molecules that are not polar are not very soluble in water. Similarly, there are other molecules which are partially soluble. An example is carbon dioxide. It's only partially soluble. It doesn't really mix very well. Then you have molecules like H2, O2, N2, Cl2, etc., which are not soluble in water. They are non-polar molecules. Non-polar molecules, they do not mix very well with polar solvents like water. So basically, you should have some idea of which covalent molecules are soluble, which are partially soluble, and which of them are not very soluble. Then when it comes to mixing covalent molecules with water, what happens is that some covalent molecules, they not only mix with water, but they also react and ionize in water. A lot of your acids, for example, H2SO4, HCl, etc., nitric acid, even ammonia, they not only mix with water, but they also ionize in water, they react with water. So I've written down a few equations. For example, HCl dissociates. Originally, HCl did not have ions. It was a covalent molecule. They were sharing electrons, but when they react with water or they mix with water, they end up dissociating, producing H plus 1 and Cl minus 1 ions. Similarly, H2SO4 is not an ionic compound. It's a covalent molecule, but when it mixes with water, it breaks down and produces these two ions. NH3 also reacts with water in a similar way, ends up producing NH4 plus 1 and OH minus 1. So a lot of covalent molecules, they not only mix with water, but they also react with water and they end up forming ions in water. So remember, HCl is not an ionic compound, even though when in water, it produces these ions. Originally, HCl is not ionic. You must also be familiar with some of the compounds, covalent compounds, that you're going to find in everyday use. So some of the compounds that I've drawn and I've described or given the description, colors and their states. The first one is SiCl4. Silicon tetrachloride, that's colorless and it's a liquid, it's a colorless liquid. HCl has white fumes of gas, as I've shown over here. You can, if you have concentrated HCl, you'll see these white fumes of gas being formed. PCl3 is a colorless liquid or slightly yellow, so it's a slightly, very slightly yellow liquid. If it's in less concentration, it's usually colorless. PCl5 is a white solid, it's a very highly unstable white solid. Then you have these halogens. You must know their description. Chlorine is greenish yellow gas. Bromine is red brown liquid. Iodine is a blue black solid. So here in this picture, you can see these halogens. Chlorine, greenish yellow gas. Bromine is a red brown liquid, and iodine over here is a blue black solid. For NH3, remember, it's a very pungent smelling. It has a very sharp smell. A pungent smelling gas. So for your exam, you must be briefly familiar with what these substances look like, because observations, a lot of questions can come on observations. The topic that we are going to discuss are giant covalent structures, or the next type of structures. These are also covalent compounds, but they are macromolecular structures. They're very large structures with many different covalent bonds. So starting first with allotropes of carbon. Allotropes of carbon are, the definition of allotrope is that they're different physical forms of the same element in the same physical state. Carbon is a very versatile element. It forms many different types of structures in its solid state. The first one that we're going to discuss is this structure over here. Now, this over here is the structure of diamond. In diamond, carbon is sp3 hybridized. Remember, we studied sp3 hybridization earlier. It is sp3 hybridized, and carbon is making four single bonds. Four electrons, carbon has four electrons. Each one is bonded with another carbon atom. So this central carbon atom is bonded to four other carbon atoms. And those carbon atoms are then further bonded with four other carbon atoms. And this structure continues endlessly with each. So remember, these dots over here, they represent carbons. So each carbon is then further bonded to, for example, this one over here would be bonded further to three other carbon atoms, and the structure would continue endlessly. The angles and the type of structure and the arrangement, I'm just going to write this down. So sp3 hybridized, and the arrangement is tetrahedral, 109.5 degrees. It's a three-dimensional arrangement. And the properties of diamond are, the diamond has very high melting and boiling points. It's a very, very strong structure, and it doesn't conduct electricity because there are no moving charges, no electrons, no ions. Why does it have a high melting point? Because the bonds are very strong and there are too many bonds. If you want to melt it, you have to break all these bonds that are holding all the carbons together. Only then will it change into liquid state or gaseous state, and the carbons would be able to free to move around. But a lot of bonds, a lot of very strong, remember carbon is a very small atom, so the bonds are very, very strong, which is why the melting and boiling points are going to be very high, and it's going to be a very, very strong structure. Based on this, one very important use for diamond is that it's used in cutting and drilling, because it's very strong, so it can cut other substances. The next carbon allotrope that we're going to study is called graphite. So this over here is what the structure of graphite looks like. It's again carbons all connected to each other, but as you can see, it's a layered structure. Unlike diamond, which was a three-dimensional tetrahedral structure, this one is more of a layered structure. In this case, carbon is bonded to only three atoms. So each carbon atom is bonded to three other carbon atoms, and it endlessly continues, and it ends up forming a hexagonal structure. So every carbon atom is connected to three other carbon atoms, and this simply continues. So you get these layered structures, these sheets. Now each carbon in graphite is sp2 hybridized. What that means is that each carbon is bonded to three other carbon atoms. So one of its electrons is unused. It's unused, its orbital is unused. So those electrons, they eventually get delocalized. These electrons, they just mix up, and they're able to conduct electricity. So you have these free-moving electrons in graphite where one of the electrons of carbon is unused, and those electrons, they become delocalized. So these sheets over here have these delocalized electrons. So end result is you get a hexagonal layered structure with all these delocalized electrons. And all these sheets have very weak, it's a flat sheet. It's a flat two-dimensional sheet. Like a piece of paper stacked on top of each other, and they have very weak van der Waals forces between them. And now, since these van der Waals forces are very weak, that also means that the layers or sheets can slide over each other. Just like a piece of paper that's stacked in a notebook, these pages or sheets can slide over one another, which makes graphite very, very soft. So the properties of graphite are, if we list the properties of graphite, so the first property is that they have very high melting and boiling points. The other property is that graphite is soft. Sheets of graphite can easily slip over one another. So that is what we talked about. The reason why they have high melting and boiling point is that if you look at the structure, to melt it, even though the sheets have weak van der Waals forces, but the sheets within them, the carbon atoms are making very, very strong bonds. So to melt it, you have to break those bonds as well, which requires a lot of energy. So high temperatures are needed. Then there's another point that they are very good conductors of electricity. Reason they conduct very good electricity is because of the free moving electrons or the delocalized electrons, they can carry charge. Charge could move around because each carbon atom has one unused electron that is delocalized and that's just freely moving around. So they're very good conductors of electricity. So those are the properties of graphite. And based on that, the uses of graphite are that they are used as electrodes in batteries. Because they are very good conductors of electricity, so battery terminals are usually made out of graphite. Plus, they're also used as dry lubricants because the sheets can slide over each other, which makes them very slippery. So, if dry lubricants are needed, they're very good dry lubricants. Now, I'm also going to briefly discuss what graphene is. Graphene is one single isolated layer or sheet of graphite. So over here is a picture or a hypothetical picture of what a single sheet of graphite would look like. If you go above and have a look at graphite, you notice that it had plenty of sheets. So if you single out one single sheet, that is known as graphene. So you have this one single sheet. Now, the properties of graphene are that it is 100 times stronger than steel. So it's a very strong sheet and it is very light as well. It's less dense. Carbon only has an atomic mass of 12, whereas if you look at steel, steel has iron in it, which has an atomic mass of 56. So steel is much heavier and has a lot more density. In this, it's a hollowed structure. So all the bonds, I mean, it's making a hexagonal hollowed structure, which even reduces the density further. Plus, graphene sheets are able to conduct electricity very well because they have these delocalized electrons. Each atom has one electron that's not doing anything, that's unused, and that forms a pi electron cloud and is able to conduct electricity. So there are plenty of useful aspects to graphene, which is why graphene has now recently become very popular. It's only been discovered or mass produced in the last couple of decades. It's a very recent advancement. And now a lot of transistors and semiconductors, etc., are being made or are being improved using graphene sheets. This image shows some of the uses of graphene. So bioimaging, sensors, tissue engineering, gene therapy, drug delivery. So lots of useful nanotechnology. Nanotechnology is a new field where you re-engineer nanoparticles. And graphene is a very useful nanoparticle, and lots of different applications involves graphene now. Now, there's another structure of graphite and related to graphene, and these are known as carbon nanotubes. This over here is an image of a carbon nanotube. So it's like a tubular graphene sheet, or graphene sheet, if you roll it into a tube-like structure, that is what it's going to look like. So carbon also forms this macromolecular structure called nanotubes. These tubular structures usually have diameters that are less than 100 nanometers. Now, some of the properties of these carbon nanotubes or CNTs is that the first thing is, if you look at the structure, it's remember carbon bonds are very strong, so it is going to be strong. But remember, whenever something is rolled into a tubular structure, its strength increases. I mean, if you take a piece of paper, which is usually very flexible, but if you roll it up into a tube-like structure, its stiffness increases. So, they're similar to graphite, so they have delocalized electrons. It's the same carbon sp2 hybridized carbon atom. Carbon forming three bonds with one electron that is delocalized. So, they're delocalized electrons over here. Carbon nanotubes have exceptional thermal and electrical conductivity because of the free-moving electrons. Then these nanotubes are also very elastic because these tube-like structures arrange themselves parallel to each other. They have van der Waals forces, so they can be stretched they have exceptional elasticity and very high tensile strength. So these are very stiff structures, so the tensile strength is also very high, and flexibility, elasticity, plus they have a low thermal expansion coefficient. So these tubular structures, and one more thing is that they're going to have low density as well because it's a hollowed structure. So hollowed structures usually have low density because they're not packed together. So there is strength, plus it's a hollowed structure, so it's going to have low density as well. These are some of the applications of carbon nanotubes. They use in electronics because of their very high electrical conductivity, fuel cells, bioimaging again. So imaging devices are using carbon nanotubes, solar cells. They're also used in agricultural fields and drug delivery. Now, I'll just briefly sort of comment on drug delivery, and that is that if you look at a carbon nanotube, you would notice that it's a hollowed structure. That means that medicine molecules could be inserted inside these carbon nanotubes, and those molecules could be protected. They could be protected from the harsh environment of the stomach. So when you consume medicines, those medicines have to are destroyed by the acids in the stomach, in your gut, etc. So before they reach the cells, a lot of the medicine molecules, they get destroyed. So you need higher doses, which leads to more reactions, more side effects. So instead of using higher doses, if you create these nanoparticles, these nanoscale particles with these hollow structures, these drug molecules can enter and reside inside these structures, and they could be protected from the harsh environment that is surrounding them, and they could be released at the exact point. For example, cancer drugs can be released at the site of a cancer cell. So that's another very useful application of carbon nanotubes, which is drug delivery. Now, another type of carbon structure, that's a macromolecular structure, not a macromolecule, but they're forming small molecules, but it's a structure, and these are called fullerenes. Fullerenes are also graphite-like. They're like graphite, but the carbon atoms are arranged in a ball-like structure. So think of a graphene sheet that has been rolled into a ball-like structure. So each carbon atom is making three bonds. So it has all these delocalized electrons. So it's like a graphite sheet, except that it's curled up or rolled up in a ball-like structure. So you have different, and it's not a macromolecular structure because it has a limited number of carbon atoms. So it's like small molecules. You could have carbon 24 that has 24 carbon atoms arranged and bonded to each other. You could have carbon 60. This is known as Buckminster fullerene. You could have carbon 70. So different varieties of these ball-like structures that look like graphite but arranged in a ball-like manner. And they have a limited number of carbon atoms, a fixed number of carbon atoms. These are called fullerenes. Now, the properties of these fullerenes are that they have high tensile strength and high electrical conductivity and high ductility. So if you look at a fullerene molecule, it's basically ball-like structures. For example, if there's C24, there would be lots of ball-like structures. They would all be arranged and they would be attracting each other using van der Waals forces. So there would be van der Waals forces between them, and they're going to be acting like small ball-like structures or ball bearings, and they would be slippery and malleable, so the balls can slide over one another. And to think of them as a structure with plenty of ball-like structures in them. So these molecules over here, they're going to be having high ductility and high electrical conductivity as usual, because they have delocalized electrons, and they are relatively chemically inactive, which means that they are planar molecules, which means that they have no, although they're not planar, they're not making straight planes, they're cylindrical planar, which means that they don't have any exposed atoms that can be easily displaced. So there would be less reactivity. There's nothing coming out of this ball-like structure, no atom attached over here. So there would be less chance of this completely planar arrangement, it would be a smooth plane. So no chances of anything getting knocked out. So some of the useful application of these fullerenes are, remember, fullerenes are hollowed structures, so they can capture different things. So for example, scavenging. So lots of biological nanoparticle, nanotechnology, they use in nanotechnology. So drug delivery. These hollowed structures, for example, the one that we have drawn above, these hollowed structures over here, they can capture different molecules and they can store different molecules in them. So drug deliveries, again, drug molecules, they have to pass or survive very harsh environment. If you swallow a capsule having a drug molecule, that has to go through the strong acids in the stomach, etc. So lots of harsh environment. So molecules that can fit inside a fullerene, they get protected by the outer layer of fullerene. So it's like a small, tiny, very tiny capsule. So used frequently in drug delivery and other such applications like cancer treatment, biosensors, etc., because of the high electrical conductivity and sensitivity. These molecules have a lot of application, and so nanotechnology is a very thriving science. It's been discovered only recently that these particles exist and they can be made to work in very useful ways. So nanotubes and these fullerenes, a lot of research is currently being done to make use of these particles. Last type of structure that we're going to discuss is they're called metallic bonding. Now, one thing that we have studied previously as well is that when you have metal atoms, metals are on the left side of the periodic table, group 1, 2, 3 in transition metals. Metals like to lose electrons. So they have a very high tendency to lose electrons. They're not very electronegative. So they like to form positive ions. So when they lose electrons, positive ions are usually formed. So this over here is a typical giant metallic lattice. So we figured out metals like to lose electrons. So you have these metal atoms all stacked on top of one another. They're all losing electrons. They're all forming positive ions. And where do those electrons go? Those electrons are just roaming around because no one is gaining electrons. So all these metal atoms, they end up combined. They're losing electrons, forming positive ions. And you have these tiny yellow electrons that are just roaming around in between the structure. These are your delocalized electrons. So free moving electrons from outer shell of the metal atoms, and you have these metal ions. So the definition of a giant metallic lattice is that it's a lattice of metal ions in a sea of free moving electrons. So electrons are freely moving around. And it's a pretty strong structure. Why is it a strong structure? Because these delocalized electrons, for example, this electron over here in the middle, this electron has negative charge. So this negative charge is acting as a glue. It's keeping or attracting all the positive ions together. So there's a mutual attraction, electrostatic force of attraction between positive ions attracted to these delocalized electrons, which are attracted to the positive ions, which are further attracted to these electrons. So you have all these electrons keeping the structure together. They're acting as glue, and they're forcing, so they're particles, positive ions and negative particles, negative electrons, and there's mutual attraction between them. So like an ionic bond, this is also a strong structure. So the first property is that they have relatively high melting and boiling points. And when you're talking about metals, group 1 metals usually have melting points that are less than 100 degrees centigrade. So group 1 metals don't really have very high melting points, but transition metals usually have very high melting points. So transition metals have very high melting points and usually it's in the thousands. So iron, aluminium, etc., cobalt, copper, they have relatively very high melting points. Another property is that they are very good conductors of electricity, which is obvious because they have these charged particles that are roaming around that can move or carry charge these electrons. These electrons can freely move around, so very good conductors of electricity because they have free moving electrons. Another property is that they're malleable and ductile, which means the malleable means that they can be reshaped. Ductile means they can be turned into wires. So why are they malleable? The reason they're malleable is that if a force is applied, these particles can slip and slide over one another without breaking. So for example, if I force push this layer or lattice of ions very strongly, these ions would shift. And let's say this entire layer has slipped slightly. So if it slips slightly, nothing would change because the attraction is still there. The electrons, delocalized electrons, are still attracting the positive ions. So even if you apply a very strong, because the attraction is strong, so you need to apply a lot of force. You really need to actually hammer the metal. Only then will it get D-shaped. But changing shape would not actually break the lattice because the force of attraction is still going to be there. So for example, this electron is still over here and the electrons would be attracting the positive ions. So the force of attraction does not break, even if you're hammering it. Remember ionic compound, the case of ionic compound. In ionic compound, they were brittle. The reason they were brittle was that, going back, this was what we discussed earlier, that if an ionic lattice slips only slightly, then ionic lattice is positive ions attracting negative ions and they're all joined together and they have a very fixed rigid lattice. So if you apply a force and the ionic lattice slips, then two negative ions would be next to each other and that would create a force of repulsion. Two positive ions would be next to each other and that would create a force of repulsion. So because of the repulsion, the lattice is going to break very easily. This does not happen for metallic lattices.
Let's now discuss the strength of the metallic lattice. What does it depend on? So here's your metallic lattice, positive ions, positive metal ions, and a sea of free-moving electrons. So the first factor is that more delocalized electrons. If you have more delocalized electrons, there would be stronger attraction. For example, in this lattice, if the number of electrons, these red dots are electrons, if you have more delocalized electrons, so I've added more delocalized electrons. So if you have more delocalized electrons, the electrons are the ones that are acting as glue. They are the negatively charged particles that are attracting all the positive ions. So the force of attraction between the positive ions and the delocalized electrons, that's going to be greater. And the strength of the bond is going to be stronger. So for example, if you're discussing three metal atoms, sodium, magnesium, aluminium, group 1, they just have one electron in their outer shell, so one electron delocalized, so fewer delocalized electrons, so the strength of the metallic bond is not going to be very strong. Mg comparatively has two electrons in its outer shell, so it has chances of losing two electrons. So there would be more delocalized electrons and the attraction would be stronger. Aluminium is in group 3, so it's going to lose 3 electrons. More electrons would be delocalized in aluminium. So between the 3, aluminium would have the strongest lattice. So here's a lattice example of a group 1 and a group 2 metal. Group 2 metal has more delocalized electrons, so the attraction is stronger. And that brings us to the second factor that's going to determine the strength of the lattice. So this second factor is that the charge on the ion. Charge on the ion is greater, that's also going to lead to a stronger lattice because of stronger attraction. So this one had a charge of plus 1, this has a charge of plus 2. So the delocalized electrons and the plus 2, they're going to be very strongly attracted to each other. So the stronger the attraction, the greater the charges. So it depends on both, the charge on the ion and the delocalized electrons. So both are greater, that the attraction between them is going to be stronger and it's going to result in a stronger lattice. Now let's also discuss the third factor, which is the size of the ion. We've figured out charges and delocalized electrons, they really matter, but the size of the ion also matters. Bigger ions, they would be very far from each other, so the attraction between the electrons, because of distance, the attraction decreases. So bigger ions are further from each other, so the attraction would be lesser and the metallic lattice would be less strong. But if you have smaller ions are really tightly packed or closely held together, So because they're close to each other, the delocalized electrons and the positive ions, they would be attracted to each other very, very strongly. So it's going to result in a stronger lattice. So remember, smaller metal atoms are always going to form a stronger lattice compared to bigger ions. And this pretty much applies to all types of bonding, even for covalent and other types of bonding, ionic bonding. The smaller the ion, the stronger would be the bonds because they're closer together and the attraction increases if you are close to each other. Next topic that we are going to discuss is alloys, which is a mixture of metals. The structure of alloy is pretty much the same as the structure of a metal with positive ions in a sea of free-moving electrons. This is the structure of a pure metal. Now, this is the structure of a pure metallic lattice. You can see that all the atoms or ions are same-sized ions. So the arrangement is going to be very neat and it's going to be a regular arrangement. Now in alloys, an irregular arrangement is formed because it's a mixture of metals. So different sized ions would be present because all metal atoms, they don't have exactly the same sizes. If you have different elements, for example, iron mixed with cobalt or nickel, both atoms would have different sizes. So the lattice would be irregular. It would not have a neat arrangement and its ions would not be forming layered structures. So the ions would be haphazard and irregularly arranged. Now that would result in one very drastic change in property, and that is that pure metals were malleable, which means that the layers would slide very, very easily if you apply a force. But when it's an alloy, if you apply a force, the layers are not regularly arranged and the ions would get stuck with each other. They are haphazardly arranged. So when you apply a force, the layers cannot really slide very easily. For example, if you push these ions, this black one, this iron from another metal, is probably stuck in its place. It would not be able to slide very easily because it will get stuck. It would be stuck by the other layers because it's a bigger size. Over here, no such thing would happen and the layers can easily slide. So that would make malleable and ductility, it would be less malleable and less ductile. Layers of ions would get stuck with each other. So that is one very major difference in the property of alloys, that alloys are much stronger and they're less flexible. So pure metals are more malleable, ductile, soft. But impure metals, which are mixtures, they're less malleable and ductile, which means they're stronger. So usually you use alloys, not pure metals, when you're making things out of metals. Now, one very common alloy is called steel. Steel is a mixture of iron and carbon, so it's less malleable and ductile. And the different types of steel, the high carbon steel, if you have more impurities in it, then the structure would be more haphazard and it would be less malleable. So high carbon steel has a higher percentage of carbon. Then you have mild steel, then medium carbon steel. Mild steel are relatively softer, so your car bodies, etc. are made from mild steel. And then you have another thing called stainless steel. Stainless steel had chromium in it, which creates a layer of chromium oxide on the top surface, which is shiny and which prevents rusting of iron. Then also discuss two other alloy examples. One is bronze. It's a mixture of copper and tin. And there is brass, which is a mixture of copper and zinc.